Welcome to another episode of Pound for Pound Boxing Report, episode 167. I am your host, Michael. If you're joining us live, I want to really apologize for starting the show so late. I had some family obligations to attend to. Came up suddenly, and I had to attend to that before I began the show. Again, my apologies. Joining me on the show this evening, Jacob from Jab Hook Boxing, Daniel from The Inscriber. I'm your host, Michael. A little bit shorthanded. Gail is not going to join us. She had a previous function. We may have a guest up on later on, but we're going to get the show rocking and rolling anyway. For those who are new to the Pound for Pound Boxing Report, Pound for Pound Boxing Report, live YouTube show / podcast, as well as blog discussing all things boxing. Motto is, when boxing is good, we will talk about it. When boxing is bad, we will talk about it. Bottom line is, if it concerns boxing, we will talk about it. If you want to find out all information about Pound for Pound Boxing Report, please go to the blog page, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com is the link. Check the right of the page. You'll find links to the pages on YouTube, G+, Tumblr, Twitter, as well as links to where to listen to us on SoundCloud, iTunes, Google Play Music, Player FM, Stitcher Radio. Let's get the show started. Recapping what went down last week. A lot of boxing went down last week, as a matter of fact. Start with the top-ranked card, pay-per-view card that took place in StubHub. I believe, Jacob, you was there at the fight's main event. Oscar Valdez fighting Miguel Mariaga. Valdez defending his WBO featherweight title, scoring by surprisingly wide margin, in my opinion, 119-108, 118-109, 116-111. Daniel, we was watching the bout live online and commenting on, I believe it was EJ's channel. Close fight, tough fight for Valdez. Mariaga was there with him all night long. The difference being the knockdown in round 10 and the strong close to the fight in round 12. Other than that, I liked the way Mariaga was in Valdez's face all night long. I love the way he kept landing the left hook to the body. Valdez landed some shots, even got his attention a few times, but that never deterred Mariaga, who kept fighting, stayed in his face all night long, and landed a fair share of shots of his own. I can agree with Valdez winning, but what I don't agree with is the how wide the scoring was. 119-108, 118-109. Ridiculous, in my opinion. To me, that lets me know that Oscar Valdez was going to win no matter what. Mariaga had no shot. His only shot was to knock him out. I'm going to go to you, Jacob, first, since I believe you was at the fight. And the reason I go to you is because your impressions, that what I saw and what Daniel saw watching it live on television or stream, and what others were commenting on social media, how did you see it from your perspective at ringside?
Yeah, I agree with you. I when they read the scores off, I was really surprised that it was that wide. I also thought Mariaga was keeping the fight close, especially the second half of the fight. He was, in my opinion, winning a lot of those rounds. And it wasn't like Valdez blew him out in the first half of the fight either. So to have it that wide, it just didn't make any sense. I agree, Valdez won the fight, and the knockdown was probably what let him win by probably like a couple points. But even in the round he got knocked down, I thought he was losing that round up to that point. And he had lost the I think two or three rounds in my opinion before that. I was there with a friend, and he also commented on it that he thought Mariaga was starting to come on and was maybe potentially going to steal that fight. Valdez, it was a good test for him. I mean, everybody knew it was going to be a tough fight. Mariaga could fight. He's a tough kid. I didn't know he was going to get up from that knockdown, but he did. Credit to him. And Valdez did try to finish him, but he seemed to run out of gas. I believe this is Valdez's first 12-round fight. Are going the full 12 rounds, but Yeah, I mean, the things that I didn't like from Valdez was that as the fight wore on, he seemed to try to like use his defense to like dodge, like with his, you know, his head kind of sticking out there and using his movement. But Mariaga was catching him. And if he probably didn't get knocked down, there's a good chance that Mariaga, you know, could have had enough power to, you know, potentially stop him or, you know, knock him down. So, you know, Valdez is I think fortunate that he was able to land that shot, which was a beautiful left hook. And hopefully he learns from this, and I hope he strengthens his defense. But you know, I think there's a lot of other contenders in the division are probably their mouth is probably watering based off that performance.
I see Scorsese has joined us. I'll go to you, and then you can follow up, Daniel, because you was watching the fight with us live as well. Look, Valdez, Jacob mentioned that round 10, one of the rounds of the year, in my opinion, Valdez landed the left hook that put Mariaga down. But Mariaga got up and kept fighting. Outside of that, and outside the last one round, which he won, a lot of credit must go to Mariaga, who, as I said, was right in his face and gave Oscar Valdez, gave him hell all night long.
Yeah, I was saying it during, I'm going to first say my apologies to Mariaga, because I thought the speedier, seemingly more fresh, the less beaten on kind of guy would be Valdez. He had the more breakthrough performances prior to that, you know. He just looked like he would go in there and dominate, and I was wrong. From round one, from the first punches I seen the crisper fighter was Mariaga, and I just continued to see James DeGale versus Badu Jack in this fight. I didn't see it going into the fight, but when Jacob mentioned the head out, using his, and him still getting clipped, that's exactly what I mean with the James DeGale. The movement was not defense. The movement was, this dude hits too hard. This dude is going to hurt me. But Valdez took the game away from himself, because he could also hurt Mariaga, unlike DeGale, who probably couldn't hurt Badu Jack. He could, but he couldn't do it to the extent that Valdez was able to do it. Valdez is an actual puncher, and we saw that. But he should have stepped in and made Mariaga go backwards at some point, adjusted his defense to keep the left hooks off of his body or to take something off of them. Start throwing your own. But, you know, he took a lot away from the performance by saying, yo, he hits too hard. And for other guys that hit hard, they shouldn't be complacent when it comes to fighting Valdez. Maybe he learns from this. But you get him on the go, you make him what he's not, and I don't think he's that mover. I don't think anybody wants to move that much, to be honest with you. I think that's something you want to do as you go up in weight and guys get bigger, guys get stronger. But when you're doing it at your first weight class, if you don't adjust to something, you eventually gonna run into problems. So Valdez gotta get better. I thought he was gonna be a pretty good fighter. Well, he is a pretty good fighter, but I thought his future might be bright after this performance. I'm saying it's a lot to take away, and I'm looking at Mariaga, and I'm saying I wouldn't mind seeing him versus the upper echelon of the division, because I want to see if they want to take those shots. He was throwing some crisp. Everything looked like Badu Jack to me except one thing, and that was a guy, when he gets close to you, Mariaga kind of didn't let his work go. He should have. It looked like he wanted to let those punches hit right at the end. He should have been working in close just as much as letting those punches rip that body shot, those left hooks reach at the end. They should have been reaching inside as well. It's just shorten up those punches a little bit and just made Valdez only option to run. But I feel he didn't do that, and I feel Valdez didn't take advantage of having the faster hands on the inside. But, you know, two fighters, they're not A-plus fighters, but they're good fighters, so you're going to see some you're going to see some things happening the way you say they could have did this, they could have did that. But then again, I'm just watching from the sidelines. I ain't got punched. And so good fight all together. And I agree. I didn't think about that, but the round of the year candidate, definitely. He was getting beat up bad in that round and came out of nowhere. Boom, dropped him. That's dope.
Yeah, the only thing I would say, kind of push back, is that the reason you kind of answered it, reason why he was moving so much was because he didn't like what he was receiving in there. He didn't like the power. and when you don't like the power, you get hit enough. Yeah, it's either to say he should stay in there and trade, but again, you're not feeling his punches, and again, and he was getting buckled, moved by those shots. So. Mm-hmm. So that's what that would be my only explanation in terms of why he was moving so much. I'll go to you on this one, Daniel. Your thoughts?
It wasn't so much the power to me. It was more where the punches were going, because it was a left hook to the body that Mariaga was throwing that was landing all night against Valdez. And he kept the pressure going. And I do have the credit, so he didn't go full-on blitz when he could have. But then again, that might have caused Valdez to learn what he learned in round 9 and round 10, which is if he can't get inside, he might do better work. So it might have turned, it would have turned the tide in Valdez's favor even earlier, had Mariaga did that. But that unfortunately, that fight showed a little bit that Valdez is a little sometimes green when it comes to his defense still. He does move well, but he doesn't move well enough where he can slip punches, at least real good power punches to the body yet. But he does have the faster hands. He does have the more accurate hands. And he can throw it from weird angles, because that you saw that shot that landed around 10. It looked like a little bit of a corkscrew right hand that he had to land in over Mariaga's left. Lands it in, was able to catch it and drop him. Now, it was a little bit of a flash knockdown. Mariaga got up pretty easily. But it's probably going to be a good learning experience for Valdez, because...
You thought it was a flash knockdown?
No, it looked like a flash knockdown. It felt like a flash knockdown. But I like the angle that it came from it, too. That shows a little bit good repertoire from Valdez, but it's a good learning lesson for him, though. Because since Gradovich, he hasn't exactly been facing real tough opposition. This was his toughest fight, and it showed. And granted, that he wants to talk about him being disrespected, not being talked to the same way that people talk about Leo Santa Cruz and Carl Frampton, and he called out Santa Cruz after the fight. Maybe he'll learn that he has to improve a little bit, get a little bit better with defense, start getting a lot better with angles, and ultimately be a good learning lesson. But you know, like I said, who's doing the Birdman hand rub? I said on either podcast, JoJo Diaz is doing the Birdman hand rub right now, because if it was a year or a year and a half ago, people would have said that Oscar Valdez would just demolish JoJo Diaz. You can't say that much anymore.
I still think you would.
I see Gus, excuse me, has joined us. We're talking Oscar Valdez and his win over Mariaga over this past weekend. Not just talk about the fight itself, but you often talk about the what Lennox Lewis calls the parlor tricks. You call yourself corruption in boxing. The judging, the scoring. To me, that speaks to the politics, to the quote-unquote corruption, because, again, as I said earlier, I can see Valdez winning, but 10, but 9 and 11 points? That's ridiculous, and I'll keep saying it. That says to me that Mariaga had no chance other than a knockout. Nope. Your thoughts, Gus?
Mike, as I always say, never underestimate the probability of corruption, because it's becoming more and more widespread. It's almost like it's no longer a surprise. It's almost becoming the prerequisite now for all of these promoters who are trying to insulate their champions, whether it's by questionable decisions, etc. But yet it definitely marred what was a superb fight. And I'm a little bit disillusioned with some of the comments I'm hearing from, you know, the panelists here. You know, are we criticizing Oscar Valdez, or at the same time, are we, or paradoxically, are we criticizing Miguel Mariaga? Because a lot of people were describing it as a showcase fight, and even Daniel did on his show with Bo. Now, it wasn't, this particular bout wasn't a showcase fight. You know, I took Mariaga at 7-2, even though Valdez has been a fighter I've been following way back since 2011. But Mariaga, I watched carefully and I knew he was a very underrated fighter who had, you know, terrific ability, but didn't get kind of the breaks because of one or two injuries before. And he had one or two other promotional issues. So he wasn't really propelled to the ranks. But he's a fighter, Mike, who would give anybody, any of the other incumbent champions trouble. So I'm not going to criticize Oscar Valdez because he definitely showed adjustments within the fight. Both fighters did. You know, I thought that was a magnificent technical war. Where both fighters, Mariaga in particular, you know, what a tremendous chin he has, because he may have been knocked down, but he came back and he had the better of the latter rounds, in which I actually scored that a 10-9 round. You know, he was dominating that particular round, had Valdez up against the ropes, and he was chopping down on him with straight right crosses, but for one time where his customary high guard before he initiates his attacks. Now that counter left hook, you know, Valdez landed was one of the best punches I've seen this year. You know, incredibly brave of him. I don't know whether it was instinct or whatever, because if had he opened up and missed, he quite possibly would have been knocked out. And for him to sort of loop it over Mariaga's right elbow, to hit him sort of pinpoint on the side, you know, what a shot it was. Credit to Mariaga, he got up, you know, he had a difficult little period, but he managed to sort of recompose himself and, you know, caught Oscar late, who was trying to open up, obviously a little bit exciting that he had his fighter hurt. But we all know in boxing, that's when you're most vulnerable. So he came back, you know, hurt him, but there was insufficient time. Otherwise, it could have been either a knockdown or a knockout on him, because he's very heavy-handed. But no, Mike, you know, the adjustments I saw in fight when Mariaga was actually having some success, he's actually very clever. He takes that sort of half step in and out. So when Valdez is looking to sort of land, he was taking the, because Mariaga was just taking those half steps back and forward. He was able to tap the punches from the head and they were hitting, you know, on the top of the gloves, on the wrist, etc. But when Valdez implements his lateral movement, and he's one of the best in the game at doing that, I don't know why he didn't do it from the outset. He pretty much chooses to stand and trade. And it may be a little bit deceptive because he's been knocking people out, but I think he's better when he's moving. Like with Oleksandr Usyk, when he's moving, I think he's better. But for whatever reason, these guys are standing and trading, taking unnecessarily punishment. If you're in the pocket, you're going to get hit. Mariaga's a very clever, he's not like a front-footed brawler, like a Ruslan or who's that Mexican with the Terminator eye now? I can't remember, the welterweight.
With the Terminator eye?
Yeah.
Margarita.
Yeah. So it's not like pressure without due regard to defense. You know, Mariaga stands up with his guard. He's surveying. Then he'll land his counter shots. Then he'll land his, generally he's straight right. So there is methodology to what he does. But Valdez later on began to sort of move a little bit. When he was firing that double jab to counter Mariaga's, his own jab. You know, he had a little bit of success, but then Mariaga came back later on where he was throwing the double and the triple jabs to counter Valdez's double jab. So, you know, both guys were, you know, exemplifying, you know, good sort of IQ in the fight to try and take the advantage from the other. So, all in all, Mike, I really enjoyed the fight, and I harbor no criticism to either fight because they were both top tier fighters.
Here's the question. Look, Daniel discussed the future for Oscar Valdez, more than likely eventual showdown with Jojo Diaz, probably sometime next year. The question is, what about Mariaga here? Will he suffer from the Richard Comey effect? Meaning, well, is he a guy that's too dangerous for his own good? I mean, he fought Walter's loss. He fought this tough fight against Oscar Valdez and damn the judges. That was a close fight, even fight.
There's a case to say that he deserves a rematch because, in my opinion, it was a close enough fight. And it was, let's say it was a 15-round fight. There's a chance Mariaga wins that fight.
Yeah, but my point is, I don't know if Aram will let a rematch happen. So,
well, no, but the question was, you know, was he gonna be like another Richard Comey? And you know, what's the future for him? Even the Walters loss, Walters came in overweight. He was way overweight, and he still finished the fight.
Yeah, but let me get my full question now. Meaning Comey, yes, he had these tough fights back to back, but he's too dangerous to get, I think, another tough fight against the top lightweights, unless he's mandatory contender. I think Mariaga may suffer from similar fate. And I'll just ask it open for everybody here. Would I be wrong there in thinking that when it comes to Mariaga?
It's both ways, actually, because the thing is with Comey, he's made really, really close fights and really, really dangerous fights for champions, like with Easter. Like, there's still an argument you can make that Comey won that fight against Easter. This fight, you have to stretch it to make an argument that Mariaga won. I think Valdez won, but it was a lot closer than what the cards had. And I do want to say one thing. I did call the card a showcase. I didn't call Valdez a showcase. That's probably the only fight that was competitive throughout. But with Mariaga, the options are a lot open because, while Leo Santa Cruz has to deal with Abdul Morris again, and it doesn't sound like Liesel being called Frampton are getting it on anytime soon, that leaves an open avenue for somebody to challenge him because he's made himself a credible opponent, particularly for either Selby. Yeah, for Selby, right now, because he doesn't have a mandatory that the IBF is enforcing at the moment. And let's face it, Lee Selby has been the most criticized when it comes to the featherweight champions when it came to level of competition. So it might behoove him to do so. Now, whether Eddie Hearn will allow it, that's another question.
I hear you, but if you're going to put a guy, if you're going to put a champion who you've invested in a good deal, if not great deal, that guy is going to want to get paid to go up against a guy like this. So are they going to put them in with this kind of guy, this riskier guy? In short, are they going to pay? Are they willing to dole out the kind of money in order to put their champions in the ring against this guy? That's my question. That's why I mean too dangerous. Put them in there. Maybe it's a mandatory, or maybe if they pay him enough, if the money's there.
He won't be a man. I'm looking at the 126 rankings, and he's ranked nowhere but the WBO. Number one in the WBO, nowhere anywhere else, top 15. So I don't know how the WBO is going to do him after this fight. But I only thing I can really think of that might happen is Golden Boy says, let's get an opponent similar to Valdez. But with him being so dangerous, I don't think they'll say, let's get a similar opponent. I might think they just say, let's go right to Valdez and make that fight. But the WBO should not drop him anywhere. Like, he shouldn't go anywhere. And a mandatory somehow should be enforced to keep him there. And that's, that he should be fighting for that title sometime soon. But the WBC, WBA, IBF, none of those champions have – they can't even if they wanted to worry about him, they can't worry about him. He's not top 15 unless some shady business go on and get him
but
in there.
But you know how the game –
But I don't think they're going to do it to fight him. They'll do it to fight – let me look at a name on here that's – in the WBO, they'll do it to fight Ronnie Rios. They'll do it to fight I know Ronnie Rios, so I know they'll do it to throw him in there, but not somebody dangerous like that. No way.
But you know how the game goes. They're not going to move this guy up, and he's not connected enough to let's just put it out there, put the money out to these sanctioning bodies to get his name up in there in the rankings. So he's going to be stuck.
I think you make a valid point, Mike. And the only way, I think, because it was a good performance, it was a really good fight. Potentially, put him back in the mix to add him to a card, and maybe put some butts in the seat. By making a solid card with like a bunch of good fighters we know that are competitive and scrap,
your mic is a little bit choppy, Jacob.
Sorry.
You're making a good point though. You're making a good point saying getting them in there on the card like they do with some of the Golden Boy cards where they might put on some of the smaller fighters of Latin descent that's gonna actually go in there and throw in a good fight. I see what he's saying there. But if you promote him, you might have to put, people might say, okay, I want your guy to fight him next. I just don't want to see him on the undercard because this dude can go, man. He can go.
That takes investment. It takes investment. Your thoughts on this, Gus, before we move on to talk other fights?
Yeah, Mike, I agree with what you and Skull say. As he said, there is no way that any of the other incumbent champions are going to select Miguel as a voluntary defense. He's too dangerous. Poses no return for any of them except a hard fight. Potentially even the belt being changed over. Now, from my understanding, he acquired this title shot by acquiring one of the Intercontinental WBO subsidiary belts or something like that.
In short, kind of a regional title, which got him ranked.
Yeah, something like that. I'm not sure exactly, what the
belt was. NABO.
Yeah, something like that. I remember them announcing it. So, hence, he could try it, that route, although it's a little bit disconcerting to a fighter who shouldn't have to be pursuing those minor belts. But I think top rank, Mike, why not sign him? Why not try and hedge their bets in going forward now? If Valdez is looking at potential shots where it's either going to be, Bob Arum, what he did say is that he will definitely try and make the fight with Al Haymon on the other side now. There is no beef for them two to actually make fights. Bob was actually talking about Al Haymon recently about how he respects his managerial sort of criteria. So I don't see any reason why unifications can't help. Now, if Bob actually signs this guy, which I think he definitely do, then in that case, at least you can try and hedge that. If Valdez does lose his belt, at least he'll have Mariaga in the frame as well. Hence, or if Valdez will go with Golden Boy with a fight with Jojo Diaz, who is the total opposite to him, that'd be a great Styles, fight. At least then he can have Mariaga there as well. I think he'll be missing a massive trick if he doesn't you know, sign a fighter of that sort of caliber who you can definitely try and, you know, you've got so many other belts. I think he beats Abner Mares. I think he beats Lee Selby easy. I think he gives Leo Santa Cruz, and I think he gives Carl Frampton hell. So why not sign him? He's still young. You know, he trains magnificently hard. If you looked at him on the scale, he looked brilliant.
He's in tremendous shape.
Yeah. He just, yeah. You know, he's a consummate professional. If you look at that Nicholas Walters fight, Mike, although Nick may have got the win, I felt Mariaga had Walters in trouble in what, round six, seven, nine, 11. Had him hurt, you know, Walters could have quite easily have gone.
Overweight Walters.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
I don't think he'd give Leo a problem, though. I think Leo would outsmart. I would love to. Damn, Gus, you're making me hungry for 126, man.
I think it'd be a great fight.
You're making me hungry. I just think Leo could take away that left hook. I really think that dude is one of the most technical fighters out, and people don't see it a lot. And I'm literally sitting here like, yo, I was thinking Valdez was going to take this dude out. Now I'm 126, got my mouth watering, man.
Let's not forget. He's got pressure, and he's got a chin, so if he has to absorb punches to try and get in inside, but he's not reckless in what he does. I see a lot of methodology. I think it'd be an intro. I think it's a tremendous fight. Well, you know, he ain't going to be fazed. He'll go for it. You know, let's just pray that these fights happen, man, because he's a real hot wire in the mix.
He is, actually. And we even forgot to mention the one fighter. Granted, he has a mandatory bout coming up, but there's still Gary Russell Jr. out there. So he's available for all the champions. The issue, though, is and it goes back into the whole point when, like, Bob Arum can speak very highly of Al Heyman and say that's new Al Heyman, but his actions pretty much say he doesn't really mess with Al Heyman that much as far as his actions. So it does relegate Valdez, unfortunately, still to that sphere of non-PBC fighters. If Al's smart, if he wants to give his, and if he wants to raise his stake in the featherweights, he should sign Mariaga. Or Richard Schaefer should sign Mariaga. Golden Boy might be smart to sign in Mariaga too. Like you mentioned it, have another featherweight in your stable. That's really, really good. The issue is going to be, to me, ultimately, and like I can see where Mike is going on this, where he would be feared, is if there's going to be enough money for one of these champions to take to go through what Valdez went through. But pride might also get in the way, because Leo Santa Cruz, say what you want, if you put him in a fight, he's going to fight. Mm-hmm. Same thing with Adam Mars. If you put him in a fight, he's going to fight. Carl Frampton, if you put him in a fight, he's going to fight.
Yeah, he hurt Abner Mares. I think he would.
The only ones you can't say that they'll fight, that they'll make out a fight, is probably Lee Selby. And that's more of an indictment on Lee Selby than anything.
Let's move on and talk about some other fights. I'm just going to spread these out to everyone. Any and everyone can comment, because, again, I apologize we started the show so late. Gilberto Ramirez, he beat Max Bursuk in his first initial title defense, but it was just, so-so in terms of how he looked. The question is, and anybody can chime in, was the win over, name escapes me right now, he won a title against the guy he won
Abraham.
The title. Abraham, Arthur Abraham. Was that an anomaly? Was that just a one-off, or is what we saw from against Bursuk Saturday night, is that more of an indicator as to what kind of fighter Zerto Ramirez is? Or is it just the fact that he's just an inconsistent guy and he needs a big opponent to really step it up?
That was my fear. Because prior, like I said, in the fights in 2015, prior to the Abraham fight, Zerto didn't impress me at all. He won, but the fight, it wasn't looking scheduled. It looked boring in a way. Even though he was winning, he was using his height, and he was using his reach to win the fights. And it felt like he reverted back in this fight to this. And that is a question, Mike. Like, is it a case where Zurdo can only step up against really big name opponents? Is he just as consistent? Or was Abraham fight just an aberration? Well, no, soon enough, because interesting enough, on Saturday, Abraham fought somebody and somehow wound up earning the mandatory spot for a rematch with Zurdo. So we're going to find out soon enough.
He shouldn't even take that fight if the first fight is any indication. He just got schooled. I mean, I didn't watch the Bursack fight. Didn't feel I needed to, but I thought at one point after that Abraham fight, I thought we was looking at the future of the 168-pound division. And I think if they fight again, I'm going to feel that way again. The kid looked flawless versus Abraham that fight.
Exactly. He looked sloppy. He looked sloppy Saturday night.
I was gonna say that, you know, the fight was not very exciting. I mean, it was so boring. They were doing the wave in the arena a couple times, you know, because people just were looking for something to, you know, hang their hat on. But
I'll bet you Jacob.
No, I didn't. But I participated for a little bit. I don't think the Abraham fight was a fluke. I do think that, I mean, we got to realize this. Abraham isn't a spring chicken. He's at the tail end of his career. I mean, I think his best days are behind him. But I also think that Ramirez, I think Mike, you said it earlier, or somebody did, maybe Daniel, that he went back to his, you know, not using his obvious advantages, which is his reach and height. I didn't understand why he fought that way. And I think he could have, you know, served himself better and put on a better show if he would have used his advantages. But he's very inconsistent. And so to me, it wasn't a good performance, especially when it was supposed to be a showcase bout. And, you know, it's disappointing.
Daniel talked about how this was maybe not that this was basically a showcase card. Well, this fight with Jesse Magdaleno fighting the Brazilian Dos Santos to me was a showcase bout arguably a showcase card. Look, I'm reading stuff about how Magdaleno, how great he looked, but I'm like, man, you do know he was fighting a nondescript guy here, so how much credit should we really give Magdaleno in this fight?
I think he deserves some credit, though, because when you have showcase fights, what you're supposed to do is take that guy out and take him out fast and prove that, yeah, it is a showcase fight. I think when these fights go 12 rounds, when you're like, man, he should have put that guy away, you know, 8 rounds ago, then, you know, then that's when the questions can be raised.
Yeah, but I'll go to you, Gus. There are still questions to be answered about Magdaleno. Specifically for me, he beat Donaire. I felt he beat Donaire, but I still wonder how would he fare against the guy who's coming at him and coming at him with power.
Yeah, and in his post-fight, Mike, he pretty much called everybody out. Ray Vargas, Hugo Ruiz, Rigo. He's going to have issues with fighters on the inside because he doesn't like to fight on the inside. He likes to rock back on his foot, sort of in and out, up and down, and then fight those sort of fast combinations. Fighter who can sort of negate his, you know, his double, triple jab, sort of pouring range finders to just sort of change the angle, come round, that can sort of negate his right hook initially, and then you'll fire the left of the body, and then take those steps. So a fighter who can just sort of change that angle, I think an orthodox fighter looking at it stylistically can get around that right hook. So maybe like a Yokonori Oguni, Mike, I think he would give him hell. I think he's just got that style coming on the inside as well. Ray Vargas and him, that'd be a pretty good Mexican showdown as well.
Vargas beats him.
Yeah, Ray is just a prototype. Eric Morales is so much Morales in him.
It wouldn't be close. It wouldn't be close. Vargas would knock the floor
again. Yeah, Vargas, no offense, but Vargas is a level above.
I agree. I wasn't, too high on Jesse before. There is some skill and ability there, but I wouldn't, if I'm Bob, I wouldn't put him in a unification. They were billing this Dos Santos as an avoided puncher, but he already got his ass kicked by Kid Galahad in the UK, so he wasn't really much of an opponent. But I didn't like the stoppage. I thought the punch was to the back of the head, so I don't know what the hell the referee was doing. But yeah, we didn't really learn much of that fight. No.
And I see Bo from Truth and Facts About Boxing has joined us. I want to backtrack a little bit, Bo. With Bo, and specifically the Valdez bout, your thoughts on the fight itself and your thoughts on the score, which I believe everybody agrees here was just far too wide.
Yeah, the score was far too wide. I would have been okay with Vargas winning by, 3 points, maybe, something like that, but that's what one score called, like 118, one, what was it, 118, 110?
One was 119, 108, and the other one was...
Yeah, that's a scorecard you walk in the building with.
Right.
He walked in the building with that scorecard and just walked in with that. But, the funny thing is what we're finding out about a lot of these young fighters is, and I give them credit for it, but a lot of these guys... they're getting to these fights where these challengers who we don't know, or some people haven't heard of, is giving them all they can handle and making what's supposed to be, like we say, showcase fights. But a lot of these guys are getting in tough fights, but it's what they need, because they need to learn right now that, it's no easy road. So I don't mind the fights being tough. I know how some people might be like, yo, you're supposed to really beat this guy, walk over him. But sometimes, man, you run into a guy that he's, no matter what you do, he's not going to go down, because he's not there just to be a part of the dog and pony show. He's actually there to win. So big ups to him for winning. But, that fight and the struggles he had against the guy he fought, it kind of makes me reevaluate Oscar Valdez a little bit. But I'm glad he won. But now you look at the 126-pound division, I don't know if that fight and the way he won that fight is enough to get him in the mix with some of the other guys. I hope he does, but the scoring was just, and that's not the first bad scoring of that night. I thought the Gabriel Rosado scorecard was a little bit off as well. I mean, I could see you giving him them the victory, but the scorecard was kind of off in my opinion.
I'm just going to have everyone jump in on bouts here because we started so late. Shakur Stevenson made his professional debut, won by stoppage, technical decision, I believe, sixth round. This fight was weird, okay? From the ring walk, in which Stevenson took extra long. I mean, this was slower than a Chris Eubank Sr. Entrance to the fight itself, marred by headbutts. Stevenson showed talent, but he never seemed to really find his flow, if you will. And the ending was there. Stopped it in the fifth, but they scored the sixth round. At the end of round five, but they scored the sixth round. And again, just anybody who wanted to chime in, I'm glad the kid won. He's talented, but this was kind of a weird.
Yeah, what's his name should have been disqualified. That headbutt was very reminiscent of the Ortiz against Mayweather.
I just caught the highlights, but you made me think about it. From the highlight, I saw that it's the most blatant shit I'd ever seen in my life. You, at some point, you do just say, "Yeah, I'm not playing with you tonight. Go home." And that could have been one of those moments.
Yeah. You put it in great context, Mike. It was weird. it was a fight where I get the guy tried to do what Salido did to Lomachenko, but Shakur Stevenson doesn't have the resume of Lomachenko. And you can still tell that he's still transitioning in many ways from the amateur system to the pros. And you can tell in the way he was throwing the punches and the way he was trying to move in and out, like he still would be an amateur. The issue, though, that's going to come to me when because he's not known as a puncher. He's going to be one of those guys that's going to have to win by accumulation. And he's going to have to learn to stay more in the pocket versus guys, because especially in his second fight, because his second fight's going to be in the Prudential Center. It's going to be a homecoming. And as somebody that's lived in the Northeast for a good amount of decade, Northeast people, Jersey, like downstate New York, they'll let you know if you're embarrassing them. If he puts on a similar performance like what he did to this fight, you might see some boo-birds in areas where you're not supposed to get boo-birds in. If it's coming to a hometown fight, but this fight was just weird. That headbutt, I'm still surprised that guy got away with that headbutt. But I'm glad he won the kid, though.
I was going to go to the Showtime card, but I'm going to switch things over here. Jacob mentioned the Rosado bout against Martin Murray. I'm going to you, Gus, specifically to start this off. Look.
You can't come to me with a Sky Sports card, Mike. What are you doing?
I mean, look, I don't even know UK folks in the YTBC who was like, what the hell, man? When it came to when they heard the outcome of this fight. In my eye, Rosado won. 119-109, another ridiculous card. Rosado was so pissed off, he was wanting to fight everybody afterwards. calling out fighters, calling out managers and promoters. He was not amused. And it's understandable after finally watching this bout in full. Murray didn't hurt him at all. Rosado was right there taking the fight to him. And again, just like we talked about with Mariago, it seemed to me, Gus, that Rosado was kind of dead man walking. The fight was going to be in favor of Martin Murray no matter what Rosado did outside of a knockout.
Yeah, spot on, Mike. When the fight was announced, I don't know who I was speaking with. It might have been EJ. We were like, Gabe is making a massive mistake coming to the UK. He ain't going to get a decision. Yeah, he always won. He got the fight through Tony Bellew, I think. He obviously started with Bellew in the film, so they're friends. So he always wanted to fight in the UK, so fair enough. But yeah, he wasn't, you know, never going to get that decision. And it was, I had it by four initially. I think you just got to go back and watch the, I think it's the third or the fourth round, Mike, where Murray is just pretty much standing with his peekaboo defense, gloves to either side of his head, which is very good for stopping hooks. Rosado understands that, deciphers that conundrum, just comes inside and whips that uppercut from distance, penetrates the guard and just rocks Murray. What does Murray do? He comes out and holds him. That was pretty much the fight summarized up.
Yeah.
Rosado was more active, more creative, hurt him a lot more. Murray was relying on a little bit of counter punching, but he's got no power whatsoever. It did look a little bit better coming back down to middleweight, because super middle was not really his, you know, his correct fighting weight. Although he is a big middleweight, but he's not necessarily a big super middleweight. But he's never really been blessed with any power. He doesn't really have, you know, any sort of combination punching as well. He tends to sort of doesn't have a bad defense at times. He can catch one or two punches, but I thought Rosado was pretty good in this fight. I don't know what the hell the commentators were talking about it. He was gassing out at the end of the rounds. It was Murray who was initiating clinches from getting bashed up to the body and stuff. You know, he looked to be hurt several times during the fight. You know, if there's any benefits to Brexit, Mike, it's just that some of these Polish judges won't be coming to the UK because, you know, they're punk ass. He shouldn't be getting visas, I tell you.
Wow. Wow. Everybody open your mics up. For those who saw the fight, please comment.
UK home cooking strikes again. That's pretty much all you have to say. UK home cooking struck again. And I like how Gus was trying to get Rosado to try to fight everybody in that arena that had anything to do with that decision. He wanted him to fight the judges. He did swing at Murray in the post-fight interview. We have to give him that. He was that pissed off. And I do feel bad for Gabe Rosado in a way because he's been a guy that's been a tough out. And a lot of times his losses have been exactly just dominated. It was just been due to cuts. Like the most famous one to me is Peter Quillen. Really, really close fight against Peter Quillen. And it was stopped by cuts in a fight where he probably might have won. If he was able to go to full 12, it's just another case of hard luck for the kid. Because think about it, Martin Murray he jumped to super middleweight, went back down when he realized that was a mistake. And now he's just simply waiting for Triple G to get all the belts so he can, so some sanctioning body will give him a title fight. Rosado's in the same area, but now it's going to be even harder for him. And fuck those scorecards, firstly.
My biggest concern is, will we see this come to fight that concerns all of us when it comes to Errol Spence and Cale Brooks?
Good question.
Will home cooking be in effect that night? Because if it's in effect that night and it happens, I can see a lot of American fighters like, fuck it, we're no longer fighting in the UK anymore.
Spence would have to put in a similar performance, not so much in skill, but just in dominance, to crawl on Linares. Because UK judges couldn't even deny Linares won those two fights.
Yeah, but still, yeah, that's a damn good question. I didn't think of that, but you're absolutely, absolutely right, Bo. So we have to be on the lookout for that late May 27th, when Brooks Spence happened. I hope it doesn't go down like that, but it may well could be. Quickly back to you, Gus, as well as you, Scorsese, because you talked about this fight with me on Twitter. Tete fought Arthur Villanueva. 1-12, but I know Scorsese, you was had some questions about Tete. You thought he was a little bit cautious in the fight.
Yeah, I feel like in another fight, I won't say I studied Tete. I just remember seeing another fight where he was the controller of the ring. He had the guy on the ropes, and eventually, I think a stoppage occurred. He broke him down and got a stoppage. And I was questioning why was this not happening with the opponent that was in front of him, because I felt like the guy had nothing, not speed, not power, not height, not size, not athleticism. I felt he had nothing on him. And I felt this had turned into one of those school ground fights where both guys kind of act like they didn't know how to fight and were too tentative to want to lead the action. And, you know, that bothered me. That bothered me. I was just like, okay, the guy doesn't look like he could go backwards. I don't know the villain the way of a guy, I will admit it, but I'm watching him, judging him from what I'm seeing, and Tate making him look like he can't do a thing. Like I said, every category, he's shining on him. And I'm saying, yo, at some point, and I even believe the commentators for Box Nation at some point was mentioning this too, and I muted them, and I just started watching myself. I'm like, drop something, move your head, drop something else with it, then move your head. See what he's going to offer back if you do the leading. Get him out of here. And you know, luckily the crowd wasn't booing him from what I recall before I muted, but I could have easily seen it happening. You know, I think they elevated him to a champion off that. I read an article or a headline where they elevated him. Congratulations to him. But as far as making a new fan, I just felt like he could have done more, and he was just playing around with what really, really should have been food in his prime like that.
Well, to be fair, Villanueva, I believe, is a former world champion. He has shown power in previous bouts in the past. And for me, I felt he won every round, and it's just going to be situations where you're not going to look sensational every time out. But I can understand your argument, feeling that Tete could have and should have done more. And to be correct, I believe Tete was declared, he won the interim championship, WBO version at 118. I'll go to you, Gus. You shared the fight with me. I caught on to it later. I finally saw the whole thing a couple of days later. Given what we just heard from Scorsese, your thoughts on Zolani Tete's performance?
Yeah, it was bizarre, sort of, you know, the whole circumstances, Mike, with, you know, the time the fight started, with the late sanctioning by Paco Cacerel, you know, who made it a WBO interim, I think just an hour and a half before the bout started. And the bout was due to start a lot later. You know, I was hearing sort of, you know, 8 p.m. GMT, but it started at sort of half past six. So quite clearly, I think it was wrong for Box Nation to have, you know, put a, you know, an interim champion so late if they're trying to sort of increase his profile as well. I know the card was in Leicester, but they had like Southern Area Champion, a very good fight that was, you know, the co-main event. So, you know, that clearly should have been for, you know, for Tete to fight, but, you know, it is what it is. But he made a very good fighter look very ordinary, and you've got to give him credit for that. I hear what Scorsese is saying, Mike, and it is a bit of a criticism to Zolani because he had that same stigma when he was even challenging, like in Argentina against, you know, Roberto Camoranesi, where he was still operating on one or two gears before his opponent would try and come back and sort of hit him with sort of volume punching that would upset his sort of rhythmic boxing. So, yeah, he does need to step it up the gears. But I guess in one side, when you're dominating the fight and you don't really want to take a risk, knowing there's a lot at stake, it was a bit of uncertainty whether it would be the, you know, the interim or the full champion, or you would have to fight for it. I heard, you know, before the bout started, he was in his dressing room. He was like, you know, what do I do? There was a little bit of uncertainty with them. And I guess what was happening with the WBO was affecting his game plan a little bit.
Yeah, get into that, because we mentioned the champion. Marlon Topalos, he defended the title either the same day or within a day or two before or after in Japan. Topalos came overweight, 2 pounds over, but he ended up winning his bout in Japan, stopping the guy in 11th round. So there's still some question. Is Tete now full champion?
Yes.
Will he end up fighting Topalos for the belt officially later on this year? Explain that.
Now, according to, you know, the rule books, it does stipulate that if an incumbent champion has missed weight, and there's a little bit of ambiguity behind it, Mike, because it depends on the extent to which a champion does miss weight. Now, yes, the belt would become vacant, and he couldn't win the belt if he won the fight, but then the belt would still remain vacant. And then had the champion, if he'd won that bite, then he has the right to fight that belt with the number one contender. But I think the problem in here, Mike, was that Topalos missed weight by 2 pounds. Now, he made no attempt to shed the weight.
Right.
And hence, that is why the WBO made that immediate sanctioning, saying, well, he obviously doesn't give a fuck. then we're going to make this bout for the interim championship. So now they may promote Ashuri to actually fight Teddy, actually, when Teddy defends the belt. So if Topalis actually made some consideration and his people actually lobbied to say, look, you know, he had a bout of illness, whatever, and he made some effort to reduce it by at least a pound, pound and a half, then it is a possibility then that the title would still be vacant, and then Tete would fight Topalis as the interim fighting for the full sort of WBO belt. So there was a bit of chaos behind it, but I think the WBO ultimately they took a punitive sort of decision towards Topalis's actions.
Actually, the WBO did elevate, I think, the next day. Tete is now the full champion.
Ah, okay. Okay. Given that, where does Tete go? Will Frank Warren finally do the right thing and invest and promote him the way that I think he should? There are some good names over in the UK, specifically at 118. Can he get those big names? The Haskins, the Jamie McDonald's. Can he get a fight with them? Anyone?
Absolutely, yes. Mike.
Mm-hmm.
Go on, Daniel. After you.
No, I was about to say yes, because they're all based in the UK. It's a good domestic fights going into it. And as good potential as Tete shows, would you put him he's not a full champion. Would you put him in other unifications? If it not against Haskins, maybe against Yamanaka? Or maybe move fight Yamanaka later on?
Later on. Not for a while, though, because Yamanaka, as we keep saying, Gus and I are going to continue to say it. He got that big fight with Neary coming up. And,
or maybe that's true. Or maybe Neary's in his future. And that would be a good test for Tete, because like I said, you don't box Neary, you fight Neary.
That would be a hell of a fight. I would love to see it. I just don't know if it will happen, because even if Yamanaka wins, I believe the money and a possible Inoue bout, would be just too enticing. And you were going to say something, Gus?
Yeah, but you know what, Mike? Maybe a changing of a guard with Neary winning the belt is actually good for the division, because Yamanaka quite clearly doesn't want to fight anywhere away from Japan, so he's pretty much not interested in unifying, you know, the belts. So maybe if it's better for the Zalanis, etc., if Neary wins the belt, because I heard an interview from him a couple of weeks ago, and he was talking about if he wins the belt, he wants to unify it straight away, whether it means coming to the UK, going to Japan, whatever. That's his modus operandi, and he's not going to waste time doing it. So I think that would actually be good for this division.
Indeed. Let's move on to the Showtime card. Headlined, of course, by Sean Porter, Andre Berto. Look, for me, Porter, look, my biggest question about Andre Berto, I just didn't know how much he had left. I didn't know if he had any legs left. And it proved to be the case in this bout. Porter, with his rough, tough physical style, mauled, was too physical and kind of bully Berto in there. Headbutts was an issue throughout, for which Porter apologized for that. Both fighters were cut. But at the end of the day, Porter was just too much for Berto. I'll go to you, Bo, and then everybody else can follow up and chime in. Your thoughts on this bout?
Listen, I picked Andre Berto to win solely because I knew that if Andre Berto lose this fight, that's it for him. We had this discussion, and I made a lot of people mad, but it is what it is. you look at Andre Berto's resume, and there are a lot of holes there. Like, there were guys he should have fought during the time that he was champion that he didn't get to fight during his era. Like, there's a lot of missing names. So I was just looking at it like, okay, this is a chance for him to fight a young, tough guy in Sean Porter and maybe show everybody that it wasn't a fluke that he was a two-time champion, that, you know, maybe he is healthy and he is back. And he got in the ring and he did everything opposite of what Virgil was telling him to do. He tried to, I don't know what he was trying to do, and he stayed on the ropes. Those body shots were debilitating. People talk about them headbutts, but those body shots was just debilitating. You could literally see shit being sucked out of him when he was getting hit with the body shots. And the reality is that Berto goes to gatekeeper status. And I mean, like, the beating, like, I don't, the beating he took from Sean Porter, I just, like you said, if he's having, it's not so much as does he have anything left. My biggest concern for him is I just think he's done. I think Andre Berto is done. He done had some wars with Caras. He had some wars with Guerrero, even Victor Ortiz. Now this one. Then you're looking at the higher echelon of the 147 pound division guys. He's not gonna be able to compete with them guys. If you think Sean Porter was a tough body puncher, Errol Spence is even harder body puncher.
Oh my gosh!
You know what I'm saying, Keith Thurman?
Please no.
Yeah, you know, Keith Thurman. Even Danny Garcia is a hard body puncher. So, I just don't know what's next for him. But all in all, the fight. We could always look at the fight and complain about the fight. It was a weird fight. It was an ugly fight, but that's Sean Porter fights. You know, it was an ugly fight, but that's Sean Porter fights. But the fact that he was able to be, like, the book is out on Berto now. You can, if you get physical with him, he mentally checks out and will not listen to his corner and do what his natural skill set is. He was fast. He had the faster hands. He had the better footwork, but he used none of that. He got baited into Sean Porter's kind of fight. But I don't really know what's next for him. But as far as I'm concerned right now, unless I see something different, you got to put him as a gatekeeper status.
I'll go to anybody else here who wants to comment. Please do so. Bo just discussed how basically this is the end for Berto. Let's talk about Porter here. He got the win, got the stoppage. The question is, where does he go from here? There's the bout with the Thurman, who was at ringside, and I've had plenty of comments about one time and his attitude, whether how he was reacting to sitting beside Errol Spence. And basically, the only reason he talked about Spence was because he was there. Other times, he wouldn't talk about Spence at all. And even after the fight, Porter was like, Thurman was giving a lot of word salad. And Porter kind of nipped that in the bud and just says, only thing I understand basically is I want another fight. So let's talk about Sean Porter here, how he looked, and most importantly, what's up for him in the future.
I think Errol Spence is about to look like the best in the division, possibly. It's very possible he's going to do something to make himself look like the best, but that doesn't necessarily mean the toughest fight when you think that Sean Porter brings. He brings an extra weapon to the ring. And I mean, Keith Thurman got the fight of his life the first time. He won the fight, but I think I would want to do something new. I think I would rather just deal with the clean work of Errol Spence and trying to keep my elbow down and catch the body shot. The shit with Porter, you got to make sure your head, his head's not on your head. And when it gets there, it stays there. If I'm a welterweight, I'm like looking everywhere but him. Especially if I already fought him. So you can't say I'm scared of him because I gave his ass a shot already. I did it when Berto got, he got nothing to be ashamed of. When he went in the ring, I thought he landed some clean punches. I thought he did the best he could do, you know. But would I want to watch Berto fight Danny Garcia? Yeah, I would watch that. I wouldn't give Danny super credit for taking that fight, but I understand it's Danny Garcia and he's going to do shit like that. So I just think they put him in there with the wrong opponent. Anybody getting in there with Sean should have the hardest time in the world getting fights. I shouldn't have to fight your forehead. And when you know it's there, at some point, the referee should say, bro, you putting it there, you keeping it there. You just, everything you do is almost based off this shit. You get me off balance with this shit. You get me to the ropes with this shit. You do every, you land, you throw a two punch combination. Third punch is your head. The fourth punch is your fist. Fist is your fifth. The sixth is your head again. And I'm just like, damn, like, what am I defending here? So I do believe Sean Porter is a tough fighter. It's nothing that sticks out that just made me say, wow, he does that so great. And then when I see how he uses his head, I said, well, that's it. And it's going to happen. It's fighters of all natures that do this. Some slick fighters, some fighters that aren't punchers. They done learned the traits of the headbutt. And just so happened that Sean Porter is a roughhouse fighter. And that's the worst kind of you to be fighting when he's on my head, buzz, because he keep it there. He puts it there. It was so bad, I thought Birdo was concussed in the ring. He was getting headbutted over the eyebrow, and he was grabbing the back of his head. I'm just like, whoa, you feeling headbutts all the way in the back of your head? You going to the hospital tonight. I'm telling you right now. And they took him. Sean Porter is just something else, man. I'm sorry. I wouldn't put my fight in the ring with him. Wouldn't do it.
Now, anybody else respond to what Scorsese was just saying and just further discussion about the future of Sean Porter here?
I don't know. Because we would, like I said, Bo put it pretty well what's Andre Berto's future. He, like I said, he hasn't been the same since the Ortiz fight. And personally, I think even though he's 33 years old, he should probably think about retiring at this point, because I don't want him just to be seen as a gatekeeper for other key fighters if he's going to show up like that. Now, for Porter, those are difficult situations because almost every other PBC fighter has already faced him one way or another that's already high value. Keith Thurman's faced him, even though now he has a chance for a rematch for the WBC. He's faced Broner. The only one he hasn't really faced is Garcia. We know Angel is never going to allow him to face Sean Porter.
Can't blame him.
Mm-hmm. And but and we know that the problem, Kenny Porter won't probably put him with Spence because Spence is too busy with Brooke. And he needs to stay busy because Keith Thurman, when he did that interview, like Mike mentioned, that he basically had to look away from Errol Spence when Errol Spence was meme-mugging
him. Pretty much.
Yeah, when he had to look away, and he said, oh, well, look for me to come back in November. November. And November's likely Lamont Peterson because he has to take care of that WBA mandatory first. So he has to stay busy. Maybe he does have to look out. Maybe Al does have to look outside, and maybe he has to pick up the phone and call Bob, because you know what good fight going into it, because they both have similar styles. Tim Bradley.
Yeah, they deserve each other. I guess they deserve each other. Nobody else should have to deal with this guy's head, man. I'm sorry, man. I don't care what he say. We tried to work on that to change it, and we try to fight as clean as we can. No, bro, you go in there and you are attacking with that thing, man. And it makes for ugly fights. It makes for you damn near to dislike watching the man fight, because you know at the end of the day, the other fighter ain't getting a fair shake. He just not. But like Daniel said, Tim Bradley, Sean Porter, they deserve each other. Bust each other up, and they deserve each other, period.
You could do that. You can do Luis Collazo too. Like I said, that'd be a tough fight for Porter. But like I said, Porter's kind of like Bradley. He's pretty much faced almost everybody of significance in his stable. They might as well fight each other.
Your thoughts on all this, Gus?
Not much to add, Mike. I just think Porter's going to be left with his dick holding in the wind, because I don't think Al Haymon values this guy a lot, because you know, he clearly made Berto the A-side in this fight. What did he get? 1.2 million versus one for Sean? So it's, that, you know, it didn't surprise me given the sort of outburst with you know, his father, you know, towards, you know, the way they've been managing his career. But, you know, he got a title shot before. Didn't quite work out for him. He's getting another one again. So I don't know what he's complaining about. He just seems insistent on pursuing that rematch with Keith. I think Keith is very reluctant to get in the ring with him.
Anybody should be.
Yeah, you can see by his style. So, you know, who knows what happens, but, you know, I don't really give a rat's ass.
Man, he's a good fighter, man. It's like taking nothing away, man. If he could clean it up, you talking about defeat of Sean Porter getting on the inside. It's amazing, man. Some of the things he does to get there, I like. He drops his hand, moves his head. I'd rather the hands be up, but if he can manage it, damn it, do it. And, you know, he could take the punishment and get there and still dull out more than he gave. It's dope to see him fight. You know, he's on the gas. But then you start seeing fighters with his hair, not his forehead, his hair personally in that face. It's like, bro, come on, man. Come on. And I think it was Harvey Dock was the ref, correct?
I can't remember offhand.
No, it wasn't. No, it wasn't Harvey Dock. I think Harvey Dock. No, that was Ben DSFS. Harvey Dock.
The fight before. Was in the card.
Yeah, he was the fight before. He was Charlo's referee.
He's lucky it wasn't Kenny Bayless Jr., otherwise he would have taken none of that nonsense.
Let's move on. Look. If Porter Berto was the roughest fight of the week, if Valdez and his win over Mariaga was the best fight of the weekend, if Shakur Stevenson was the weirdest fight, maybe the most impressive individual performance was Jermell Charlo, who fought on the undercard of Porter Berto. Charlo, for the ring first time, I believe, in 11 months, stopped his mandatory challenger, Charles Hatley, stopped him, I want to say, I can't remember the round right now offhand, but still, look, Charlo, people forgot about him, but he just basically let the folks know, when it comes to 154, don't forget my name. He beat this dude Hatley in every way. I thought the speed of Hatley and a little bit unorthodox style of Hatley may give him problems because he fights, he's a switcher that fights orthodox in southpaw, a lot southpaw. Six round stoppage. Beautiful right hand at the end of a, seemed like a 20 punch combination. Mm-hmm. Off the shoulder, just took him down and out. But still, two knockdowns in the fight. The speed didn't bother him. You saw the strength and the power here. Charlo is cementing himself. He's sticking his foot in the ground and saying, I'm here. And I love the fact that afterwards, and anybody can chime in on this fight, I love the fight afterwards. Give me Andrade. I want to fight him. I like the fact that he's not Andrade. Give me Jared Hurd. I like the fact that he's calling out another game, another name, another one of the young guns in a possible unification bout. Your thoughts, anyone?
I'll jump in. You mentioned the 11-month layoff. I think that's about right, but he didn't miss a beat. It just looked like he missed beating people ass. That's what it looked like he missed, and he went in there and put on I got to shout out his trainer first, because with Ronnie Shield, he was considered, oh, I got a good left hook. I got a good left jab. I'm considered an out boxer. Derrick James turned this motherfucker to a fighter. I'm talking about straight right hand turns into a right uppercut. Then it might be a right uppercut again with a straight right hand and a hook. And that's where that 20-punch combination sort of came into play. When I shadow box, some of the things I like to do, I like to just use the same hand and say, and I noticed that in him and say, damn, he doing that. And he was whooping at Liat. The jab was working. The straights was working. The hook, everything he wanted. He beat this dude into looking like Uncle Roger Mayweather. He already looks like Floyd Mayweather. He interrupted a press conference. I called him Lloyd Mayweather one day. He made him look like Uncle Roger. And every time he hit him, his face curled up. I said, oh, shit, man. There's some power on those punches. And he did. He cemented himself as one of the names at 54 that now when you mention people, you say, oh shit, I thought he might have been one of the worst champions. But it just goes to show that I can't think of his name, Jackson. Jackson's actually pretty damn good, man. He just can't take a punch that well. Like, that just goes to show what he can do. But Jermell Charlo definitely made me want to see him get active again this year. And I know Hurry said he wants to get two voluntaries in. But look, you got that belt, man. People want that thing. Yeah, you of age. You've been in a tough fight with Tony Harrison. You got the experience you need. If it comes to unifications, I can't justify him turning anything down with these hungry fighters like that. And that would be a hell of a fight. But I was supremely impressed with what Jermell Charlo did in New York. That was amazing.
Anybody else want to comment on this fight?
Yeah, let me jump in. It was Charles fucking Hatley. and it was Charles fucking Hatley. Like, he's not even the most popular fighter in his home in his own goddamn state. But what we saw was the difference between a guy who is a professional fighter and a dude that still fights like an amateur fighter. Hatley was making some mistakes that was just brutal to fucking watch. I started doing something more interesting, like fucking arranging my socks in my drawers. Seriously, I mean, what the fuck? This was Charles Hatley. Look at the mistakes this dude was making. He was going straight back with his head up every time. He was allowing Charlo to get the angle on him. Then the punch that knocked him out, when you miss a punch or you're in a clinch, you reset. He never resets and allows Charlo to get the angle and hit him flush with the right hand. That's why, I mean, yeah, I give him credit for the win, but I knew he was going to win. Why? This is Charles Hatley. It's Charles fucking Hatley. Yeah. This is the dude that interrupted a press conference on the wrong fucking Charlo.
But think about this, though. You can't say this guy. I know. Look, I'll admit this. His last fight was longer than Charlo's ago, basically. But he went all the way to Australia to put an L on Mundine's resume. Mundine's a made fighter. He's a guy you just ain't going to walk up and beat. Even at that age, you're not just going to fly to Australia and beat Mundine, man.
No,
it was Charles fucking Hatley. Mundine
has always been more mouth than fighter. He's always been more mouth than fighter.
Yeah.
He has been. Yes, but all I'm saying is, look, I will give him this. Derek James has him sitting down on his punches. He is throwing more power now. I'll definitely see that because he was more known for being for boxing. So Derek James has turned him into somebody that can sit down on his punches and throw us some power. But I wasn't overly like I knew he. It was Charles fucking Hatley. I knew he was going to beat this dude.
You got to fight the Mandos, and he did it impressive. He landed a power shot.
I give him to an angle and
give him more, man. This dude was actually fighting, and it's going to give anybody problems. If he's confident enough to go in there with Jared Hurd, say, I'm going to lead with a power shot, jump off to the side, give you more power shots, then Jared Hurd got a damn problem on his hands.
But Jared Hurd is not Charles Hatley.
Your game plan is your game plan. If your coach is coaching you to do that.
Scorsese, you're giving Charles Hatley more credit.
No, it's nothing about Charles Hatley. It's you saying, I'm going to be the man that follows my coach's game plan. If Derrick James has him throwing a straight right hand, jumping off the angle, throwing a right hook at you, if you follow that against anybody, that's just what you're gonna do. And if you do that versus the best in the world, then you making the best in the world contend with something they normally don't see a man confident enough to do versus them. I would love
to see well have seen that. That's why they're the best in the world. What I'm saying is though, it was Charles fucking Hatley. I knew he was gonna win this fight because what we saw was a guy who has turned the corner as being a professional versus a dude that still fought like an amateur.
But let's give him credit for that. Let's say, well, hell, he's looking impressive. I'll give him
credit for it, but it was Charles. I'm not going to say he looked impressive against a dude that I already knew he was going to blow away because this motherfucker.
He did. I've seen Charles Hatley fight before. I don't feel like he's just no walk through the park.
That's good for you, but it was Charles fucking Hatley.
Let's move on. Let's get others into the conversation, please.
Derrick James is doing what Scorsese is saying with Charlo. He's making him sit down his punches. He's burying his attack. He's making him land. And mm-hmm. now with Jamal out of the division, because he outgrew the division naturally, there's almost no excuse now for Jamal to start making these unification fights. Now, granted, he mentioned Herd. He didn't mention Lara. He probably is not going to mention Cotto, because we all know as soon as Canelo drops that belt, the WBO is finally going to find one way or another to slap that belt on Cotto.
They gave that belt to the Walsh, Liam Smith winner. That they already got a champion.
No. Canelo's still trying to be the champion.
Somebody came in overweight for that fight. That's why nobody won that belt.
It's Liam Smith, and then Liam Smith won the fight based on a bad cut. Mm-hmm. No, there's no interim champion. Canelo's still technically the WBO champion.
The interim is vacant.
Yeah. So I'm glad the fight that Jermell wants to do these mandatories, though. And I did like the way he did the knockout. It wasn't like a punch that he cocked all the way. It was a nice, short, crisp right hand, landed beautifully. And we don't even know if Catley was halfway out. And then the camera that he hit took him out completely.
He was out on the way down. He was falling face first. He was out of there. Charlo gets all credit for that.
I'm not saying that Charlo shouldn't get credit for it, but it was really a good performance. Now, fighting Andrade would be a pretty actually poetic justice in a way, because he was supposed to fight Andrade when Jermell was his mandatory for the WBO junior middleweight title. Until Andre decided to listen to Jay-Z. It almost is a little bit poetic justice now that Jermell's a champion. And Andre now has to go to him.
Your thoughts on this, Gus? Well, I'm sorry, you wouldn't finish, Daniel. I'm sorry.
No, but to Bull's point, Charles Hadley's a pretty tough fighter, but he's still Charles Hadley.
Any comments on this, Gus?
Yeah. Mike, Jared Herd puts Charles Hadley on the shiny white stretcher within two rounds. I mean, I'm convinced of that. You know, Charles, who's been out for what, an extended layoff?
2 years.
Involved in an acrimonious, lawsuit with his own promoter. Now he has the fluidity and the creativity in his legs, like he's been bitten by a South African black mamba snake. But that's still, Charlo didn't even have the ability to cut off the ring properly, so he just kept making the same mistake that I saw that he was making in the John Jackson performance. So I didn't see anything spectacular whatsoever. All right, I saw a guy mounting, all right, you're mounting a good offense, but what, on a tier C level opponent? I ain't going to give him any credit for that. Just stationary target. Bo was absolutely right. A guy who didn't have the ability to reset was going backwards in what? Mimicking in small little movements, but his head position was stationary. When he would come forward, it would be exactly in the same position. Like somebody giving him a tranquilizer in his neck or something. I don't know. I'm glad he's calling that, Jared Herd. We need some unifications. It'd be a good fight, but I think I certainly would favor Jared Herd, Mike. I think he has that ability to, to fire punches from long range and counter punches as well. I think he's brave. I think he'll take punches to inflict punches. I think he'll cause Charlo all sorts of problems, especially on the inside, if the two will engage on the inside. So,
I felt I did see him stepping and cutting down the ring more in this fight. I felt I was seeing that, and I credited that to Derrick James once again. Like I said, the other fight he got might be the best in boxing at cutting down the ring. And I felt I was looking at damn near Errol Spence again. Like, I felt the trainer has made a huge impact on this fighter. And once again, I say, I get it, level of opponent. But sometimes it's your confidence that tells you when you can do. This man been sparring Errol Spence daily. Okay, it's your confidence to say, I don't care if you're a B, I don't care if you're A, I don't care what you are. If I want to throw this right hand and position you to jump around you and get ready to throw a left hook or a right hook or whatever, I'm going to do it because I'm trained to do that. And the best in the world sometimes don't get people that want to do that versus them. So we'll see what happens if he keeps that confidence to do it. That's all I'm saying. I'm telling you right now, if I'm training and fighting, I'm not going to let what I think of you determine what I do. I'm going to say, I want to be on the front foot. I want to hit you more than you hit me. I'm throwing the right hand, and I'm jumping off on that angle, and I want to come get more. And if that's what he wants to do, he's going to do it, in my opinion. I just see it. I see a confident fighter. I see a guy that's been world-class sparring every day. I'm ready to see these unifications. The vision need to get hot.
That set of his lines only denim coat on. Take it off, Scores. Take it off, my man.
Yeah. Just my perspective on it.
Let's move on to some news here. Only one main story I want to talk about here. A couple shows back, we questioned whether it was too soon to hail Vasyl Lomachenko as pound for pound top dog in the sport. One of my complaints was that if he's really about that and they want to make these comparisons to Whitaker, Lomachenko ought to pull a Whitaker. And what I meant by that was Whitaker lost opportunity to hold Jose Luis Ramirez, controversial decision. Many felt he won. Whitaker eventually ended up winning a belt, and what did he do in his first fight following after he won? He ran it right back against Jose Luis Ramirez, dominated him, and got the decision. Lomachenko, early in his career, I believe his second, third fight, fought Orlando Salido, lost in a tough bout. But since then, he's done a lot, won two world titles in two different weight divisions, and has been a lot of praise has been heaped on him, and HBO is basically already proclaiming him as pound for pound top fighter in the world. And my thing is, okay, if you want to do that, that's your prerogative, but can we at least have Loma go back and fight the man who defeated him? Well, it looks like that fight is indeed going to happen. News broke yesterday, reports broke yesterday, apparently quoting Bob Arum saying the fight is going to happen next. Either July or August, possibly in LA. So I'm going to ask everybody here in the panel and hangout your reaction to reports that indeed Lomachenko and mute whoever had that plate going on in the background. Reaction to reports of Loma indeed going to run it back with Orlando Salido. Anybody can respond. Open your mics up, please.
I'm actually glad that's happening. I'm glad. I've been telling people that that's what Lomachenko needed, and the reason why I was saying it is because the reality is, if you want to tell me this guy is a potential great fighter, if you want to tell me this guy is another pound-for-pound fighter, All great fighters have always had an opportunity to at least get revenge for some of their losses. It don't always work that way, but we at least want to see it. And for people who get upset when you bring up Orlando Salido, the reality is, well, guess what? They didn't rematch. If he rematches with Orlando Salido, and I believe he wipes the floor with Orlando Salido now, but if he rematches and he beats him, well, Orlando Salido beat him. That can no longer be the tag on him now. It's like, he got his revenge back now. So I'm glad it happened from that aspect of Lomachenko should be getting this the chance to avenge this loss. And we'll see if he has learned, which I feel like he has, but we'll see if he has learned a way to defeat that grimy come at you type of style. So I like it. I'm glad it's happening. I have Lomachenko winning this fight because Orlando Salido has more mileage on him, and Lomachenko is coming into his own. So I like it. I'm glad it's happening.
Scorsese, Daniel, Gus, your thoughts?
how did LeBron put it?
About damn time.
Yeah, about damn time, because that was gonna follow Lomachenko like a scarlet letter. No matter who he fought next, because if you're gonna try to claim yourself into that fight, you got to prove that you can beat the guy who beat you. And I like his confidence in his saying that. Like, remember in that post-fight interview, he said it was a third grader fighting the high school senior. Well, I graduated from college now. Now you get a chance to prove it. You need to prove it. Because otherwise, it's not going to look good for you. Either way, because that question is going to follow him throughout. It didn't matter who he beat at 130, who beat 31. If he goes up to 135, the question will always be, well, you never rematched Salido. So people think that you just don't like those type of fighters. Well, now it looks to be the case where you're now stepping up and you need to prove that, okay, these accolades that are being thrown on me that I'm now number one pound for pound, they should be legitimized. More legitimized now because I beat the guy who beat me. And I do think skill-wise, Lomachenko is better leaps and bounds than what he was when he fought Salido. The first time. I don't know how he's going to shape it up in the second time. But I'm glad it's happening.
Go ahead, Gus and Scorsese.
Yeah, Mike, I'm disappointed. I'm angry. I'm pissed off. I'm not happy about this fight whatsoever. You talked early on about Errol Spence, whether he would get any sort of justice or a fair, balanced adjudication when he comes to the UK, given what has been transpiring in the UK. Now, is Orlando Salido, do you think he's going to get any sort of justice now? Because they're almost setting him up for the fall now. I don't give a fuck about, you know, Vasil trying to avenge a loss now against, you know, a veteran who's been in war after war after war. So there is going to be degradation. There is going to be deterioration. Who knows? He may not even be the fighter that he was. So what's he going to prove? Nothing. He was old manned and beaten legitimately in this fight. Don't give me no bullshit that he was 10 pounds heavier. I can give you example of 20, 25 fights in the past where fighters have gone into the fight, you know, going from midweight to heavyweight, giving away 40, 49 pounds. So, and you consider yourself one of the all-time greats. So don't give me no bullshit there. The thing is, Mike, Vasil has gone from Rocky Martinez, a shot fighter, to Nicholas Walters, somebody who he psychologically already had won the fight before, not paying him what he deserved to be paid at the time. And he's doing exactly the same with Orlando Salido. Have you noticed the pattern here? Offering this guy derisory money before he had one of the wars previously where he had an opportunity. So now he's going to, what? They give him, what, an extra 50,000-60,000 pounds? Nah, it doesn't prove anything at all, Mike. I think it's disgusting. You know, fuck Robert Arum and fuck Vasilim Lomachenko.
Damn. Scorsese, your thoughts?
I guess I don't have to wage the war versus Loma no more, like people normally say. Shit, Gus took care of that. But no, I mean, I don't think. I'm just sick of saying, all right, this is all you got to do to be pound for pound. We know where that agenda is being pushed from. I look at fighters, and I'm not saying it's because one is my favorite fighter. I'm just respecting what he's done. He started at 130, went to 135, won a belt, has a victory at 140 pounds, and now trying to chase a 140-pound title. That'll make him a three-division champion. He's not even being mentioned for a top 10 pound for pound. But you can have a loss on your resume, have your promoter set everything. And I was talking about Rancis Bartholomew, but Lomachenko can have a loss on his resume, set everything in stone to have things his way in the ring, basically, and he looks good. But at the end of the day, man, it's about 100 fighters any given day. I say, you know what, that style to beat that style, this style to beat. I'm so over this pound for pound mess. My pound for pound list is number one. They got a guy, my number one guy, he gets no love from nobody, and he's my number one guy because it's proven somebody didn't want to fight him. That's supposed to be number two. I basically make a joke of these lists. He's a good fighter. Don't try to sell him to me as something I haven't asked to buy him as. When I walk into the grocery store, the hot dogs don't jump off the shelf, say, get me. This ain't, what's that, that supermarket movie, Sausage Party? No, they just sit there and I decide what I want to buy. So, you know what I mean? So I'm making my decision that Brazil's a good fighter. I'll watch. He does need to avenge the loss, but this ain't no damn number one pound for pound fight. Like, cut it out. Okay, sell it to somebody else, I guess. Sell your guys, I understand. But to me, I'm not going there with these HBO, PBC, Showtime, nobody. I'm taking these guys for what I see them as, and I see them as a good fighter. I see this as a rematch that should happen. It's other fights I want to see, but hell, it's boxing. You get what you get.
Any Mike, final word? Go ahead.
Mike, I want to add one thing because I had a huge argument with somebody. The thing is with Lomachenko, and somebody posed the question, they said, name somebody that has done better than Lomachenko in under nine fights. And I said, Naoya Inoue. And everybody got angry when I said it. And I said, okay, well, he was the first one to win two titles in under 10 fights. He did it before Loman did it. But here's the thing. He beat Adrian Hernandez, who was the, I believe he was the linear champion of that division at that time. And he had seven straight title defenses where he was the man. Then he went up and he fought Omar Navarez, who was the linear champion. And he had eight straight title defenses. So let's break down the Lomachenko. He lost Orlando Salido, fought Gary Russell for a vacant title, and then fought Rocky Martinez, who pretty much was a paper champ because he fought for a vacant title. And whenever I point that out, people get mad at me and say I'm hating. I said, I'm not hating. I'm still acknowledging the boy is gifted. But sometimes we have to put things into its perspective. What's more important, beating a linear champion who has several title defenses or beating a guy for a vacant title? And unfortunately, the popularity of Lomachenko is growing to the point where when you say something bad about him, they think you're hating on him. And it's not hating on him. You're just keeping things in perspective.
And that's a good comparison because while Lomachenko is a unique talent for sure, is he that much better than Inoue? Is he that much more talented than Inoue? And you know, relative to divisions and whatnot, we know Inoue hits harder, and it could be argued that he's a more exciting fighter in many ways. He takes more chances. So I didn't think of it in that perspective, though. But after listening to your argument, I have to agree with you. You're absolutely right.
Let's keep it.
And he defeated Taguchi as well. You know what I mean? So you know, the current WBO champion, first guy to an inflicted defeat on him. So yeah, Inoue's resume is so much better.
And I get where Bo's coming from, because I had this, let's keep it in division, where I'm arguing with this one guy and I'm telling him, yo, I believe it's a fight in the division and went over and knocked the number one guy had left a trail of bodies at 130 pounds. I didn't know what I was watching when I watched him. I completely almost could not understand why these guys couldn't take his punches. Uchiyama had left a trail of bodies, and then the dude go over there and spark him, and I think it was two rounds.
Yep.
And you mean to tell me what Lomachenko did versus Rocky Martinez was more impressive?
Oh, no, none of them did that. He beat him twice in Japan.
And that's why I told him, I said, bro, I don't care what the ESPN rankings tell you. That guy's the number one in that division. No disrespect to Lomachenko. It's just Lomachenko likely didn't get the chance to do it. But, you know, like you said, the popularity of Lomachenko just outweighed common, not well, I guess you can't say common because it ain't too damn common, but I guess you could just say hardcore knowledge. I guess it just outweighed it. I see where it's coming from. That shit's annoying.
It's not just like the little popularity. I know, Bo, like we had you had a show, we had to dissect this a bit. A lot of it's also nationalism in play. because a lot of these guys that are picking in, they're mostly Ukrainian. They're going to defend Lomachenko to the death, and you can't point out flaws to him. And that's going to change soon, though, because remember, it said come September, Mr. Nui is going to be on American shores. And people are going to see what they've been missing out on Japan. That may change quick in a minute. Because think about this also. HBO has been like looking to crown a number one pound for pound almost simultaneously. One guy's got a loss. They had Chocolatito number one for how long? Then he lost. Oh, we have to put on somebody, Lomachenko. Even though you can make the case, Corrales is technically the lineal champion because he beat the guy who laid waste to the division, Uchiyama, for years. Like I said, he did it twice in Japan. So I get some people not really liking Lomachenko in that way, like kind of pound for pound, because he still has to earn it in a lot of ways. That's just it's a, if he that's why one of the things when I said when you asked the question a couple weeks ago when you said it's the number one pound for pound, I said I might change my mind at the end of the year. This is one of the things that could make me change my mind. Avenge your loss, and then if nobody else is gonna fight you, okay, go up to 135. If Linares and Mikey already got it on, and if it doesn't turn out to be a bloodbath, Jorge Linares will be waiting for you, boy. And he has footwork and he has hand speed that you have not faced yet as a pro. So you want that number one pound for pound Lomachenko? Come and earn it.
Let me just throw in there. I still think Tavin Farmer could possibly give Lomachenko a really good fight, but I know I'm one of a few who thinks that, but I just have to put that out there.
He was in camp with Lomachenko. He was in that. That's not far. He was in camp with Lomachenko, so normally sparring partners are more familiar with you.
And I just have to put me and Isha, the casual boxer fan on Twitter. We may be one of a handful who thinks that, but you know, I just have to put it out there. Let's move
Mike,
on.
Just make one very, very quick point. The protection that Lomachenko has received, Mike, stems back to his amateurs as well. I'll tell you how much of a protected fighter this guy is. If you go back to the Baku World Championship, he fought against a Brazilian in the final who won gold in Rio. And this Brazilian actually beat him. But for whatever reason, they went back and made a retrospective adjustment, and they awarded the fight to Lomachenko, which was a travesty at the time. I can't remember the guy's name. I think Top Rank have signed him as well. Could be Conseil Sal. The name just eludes me, but I don't know whether the footage is out there, but yeah, he clearly got beaten in the final. So this guy has been protected for so long.
let's move
no,
on.
No, of course, there's ain't got a problem. I was ringside watching him live against Felix Vadeo. I actually spoke to him briefly as well. I got no problem with him, but you know, there's other ways of seizing your destiny if you think yourself to be the all-time greatest, which he does. You know, he's even said that. So prove it.
Yeah, that's all. Just prove it. It's not just prove it, but let's not be so quick to anoint someone to a certain position who hasn't done the necessary things to really deserve that distinction. So yeah, that's just my only thing about that. Let's move on. Previewing really the big fight of the weekend. Probably the big fight of the year up to this point. One of the biggest fights in UK history, period. One of the bigger heavyweight fights in quite a while. Certainly since Fury Klitschko, I would argue it's even bigger than that. Yep. Anthony Joshua, Vladimir Klitschko fighting this weekend, Saturday in London. It's going to be aired live here in the US on Showtime, 4:15 p.m. Eastern start time. HBO is going to air it on tape delay basis at 10 p.m. I'm going to you on this one, Gus, since you are there in the UK. The vibe, the scene, the atmosphere. I'm hyping and talking a lot about it here. Does it deserve it based on what you were seeing from the reaction of the folks, the media, in the UK?
The magnitude of this fight, Mike, I didn't quite realize until this week in particular. Looking at the number of media that have assembled in London and the number of engagements that the media have had with the fighters and worldwide television crew, it's a huge, huge fight. On par with pretty much anything. Now, it may not generate the monies that the Floyd Mayweather Manny Pacquiao did, certainly from the pay-per-view side, but as a spectacle, given the sort of volume of people that will be attending the fight, it's one of the biggest fights in history. The level of, Mike, I've had my green grocer asking me about the fight. I've known him 20 odd years and he's like, he's never spoken to me about boxing before, but he's like, I'm going to be buying this fight. What do you think? And I'm like, oh my God.
I don't think I heard what he said.
I heard him. That's
why they come here. We know what he said. We know what he said. That does not escape the US, UK vernacular trap.
I heard him. I'm just not trying to promote
it. I never heard it put that way. I said something because I'm thinking like, I was thinking like,
That's why I couldn't say nothing. I was on mute.
I heard him.
I'm sitting over here thinking like, is he a vegetarian? Then I'm like, oh, this is Gus just talking.
I could respond to what Gus was doing last week, doing a hangout this weekend, but I'll refrain.
I was buying some coriander and cucumber, man.
Okay. You can't pull off the Gus. You can't quite pull off the Jeezy with Young Jeezy with the asparagus when he came out with asparagus there. But yeah, you've been dropping some one-liners this year on this show.
Anyway, proceed on to the fight in your preview, Gus.
Yeah, but in terms of what I've been seeing this week, Mike, with a friend of mine who's been attending, like he was over there on press row. He had an interview with Vladimir, and what he's conveyed to me is that an extremely relaxed Vladimir, Mike, a complete sort of polar opposite of his mental framework. Within the Fury camp, who just psychologically had killed him before the fight, wouldn't accept any of his antics. But in this fight, there's been so much good spirit between the two fighters. And Vladimir has been the one instigating the jokes, the sarcasm, etc., with the media, the way he's been interacting with them. Joshua has seen a little bit more subdued. It's not new for Vladimir, Mikey. At Gelshen Kirshen, he's fought in front of, 62 against Ruslan Chagayev. In Hamburg, he's had up to 58,000, 59,000.
Yeah.
So he's had, and my uncle was actually over there as well. And I had a couple of friends attending the fight in Germany. So they were telling me that they had like 3-4 day press events before. So it was a pretty marquee sort of event over there. So nothing new to Vladimir. Looks like he's enjoying it. Friend of mine, he attended the workout as well after the press conference, saying that, he looked sharp. He was on his feet. It seemed to think that he's going to try and implement a lot more lateral movement early on in the fight. I think his feet are definitely better than Joshua, so yeah, he may go back to that. But it's huge, Mike. I guess the pay per views is going to I don't think it'll surpass the Pacquiao. Floyd, it may not even do the Ricky Hatton and Floyd Mayweather, but it'll certainly get up to about 1 million, I reckon.
Who you got officially, Gus? Go on in.
As soon as the fight was announced, Mike, I took Vladimir by knockout. It gave me the best opportunities. I don't know, Mike. It's a lot of people are saying it's either going to be Anthony early, Vladimir late. I would certainly support that. I think Vladimir does have the better feet. He's not going to be in the position where Joshua is going to be able to land punches on him as easy. Physically, they're exactly the same. Vladimir is going to have to use his jab quite effectively. He's going to have to use his legs as well to get into a range. He's going to have to try and use lateral movement the same way Fury did. And I think that's the way he's training, and that's what I could see from his workouts to try and, you know, off balance some of, you know, Joshua's straight lines approach. But Joshua's been getting a little bit better and better, so you just don't know with him. He's been increasing his arsenal as well. He's been developing those hooks, which he didn't have in his early fight. I think the key punches in this fight is going to be the left hooks. I think Klitschko's left hook in particular, which he doesn't really use as much, but is an effective punch. I think that could be one of the key punches. Joshua's, if it goes beyond the, you know, Anthony hasn't been beyond seven rounds, so we don't know what the hell his stamina is going to be like as well. It didn't look good against the Dillian White fight. He was certainly gassing, but he caught his second win to knock him out, and that was the first time he had a bit of adversity. Yeah, as I said, Mike, I've got a hedge position. I've got Joshua by knockout between 1 and 4, and I've got Vladimir 15-2 winning late by knockout. So I guess I haven't really answered your question.
Hesitancy is understood because you just don't know. You don't
too
know.
Many questions.
Yeah, you don't know what Klitschko has coming off of a long layoff at this age. Joshua is still unknown. I'll just go to everybody else here.
You want a solid one? You don't want no hesitation? I got you.
Okay, go ahead.
Joshua by murder. Joshua by just brutal old man retirement type package deal. Sign seal. It's over. I'm going to get my big bro. Oops, I can't go get my big brother. He's old now too. Like this ain't the fourth Klitschko rebirth. He's had to rebirth his career about 2 or 3 times. He ain't doing it to Saturday night. No, the guy puts his punches together too well. Klitschko's gonna have those arms, those Frankenstein willow tree arms going on. He's not seeing stuff coming no more. Like that's, I think there's so much importance in, oh, he's gonna use this kind of movement. At some point, it's gonna be a fight. At some point, he's gonna have to see the fight, and he's not doing it no more. It got to the point where he couldn't see it with Fury. That Fury basically was hugging his back or something. There's a famous picture out there. I put it up today where his back's just turned, and you saying, "Yo, that's a sign that this man is everything's catching him off guard. The reflexes, something ain't there no more." And then you want to sit out for a year and make me think it's that look. If it wasn't, I don't know. I don't want to be too harsh, but if it wasn't for Joshua being this huge, I just feel like the real skills of Klitschko could, at this point, could be saying, you know, maybe 8,000 people should show up to watch him. That's about it, because it's not much there no more. So much more to see in boxing. I'm going with straight up brutal. Gus getting some money between rounds 1 and 4, in my opinion.
The concern, I'll just ask anybody here, does anybody have any concerns about Klitschko, who's known for holding a lot, leaning, using his size and strength to lean and wear out guys? Is there any concern on your part that maybe the referee will not check Vladimir for excessive holding?
This fight's in England. Mike, this fight's in England. If anything, the referee's probably giving more punishment to give room to Joshua. I'm gonna just bluntly, like I said, we've seen a rash of UK home cooking lately, and this is probably the perfect recipe to do it in, to prevent Klitschko from holding in. But this fight is hard. I said it last night with Jerome Francis. My heart wants to say Joshua. My heart wants to say it's a new era in the heavyweight division. This guy puts his punches well. He's a convention sound guy. He has a great right hand. But my head is saying Klitschko. Because unfortunately, and this is one of the makers you can have on Joshua, you can legitimately say that his toughest fight was Dillian White. Not winning the title against Charles Martin. Not his two defenses against Brazil or Molina. It was Dillian White. A British level fight. And unfortunately, Klitschko is a leap in class compared to the guys that Joshua's been facing.
Daniel, get it right. It's Delilah White.
Delilah, yes. Okay, yeah. We shout out to Del Boy. But the issue to me is also, like I said, because we haven't seen Joshua with really good caliber fighters, is we don't know if he can really take a punch. And Klitschko does have his own right hand as well. So what happens if it turns into a fight and Klitschko lands the right hand and Joshua falters? What if Team Klitschko actually looks at the video Dillian White fights and realizes that you hit Joshua to the body a few times, he's not going to like it. Pardon me. This is actually
not much of a body puncher, though.
Yeah, that's what I mean. That's what I'm about to say. Yeah, but it's more of a headhunter. He's always been a headhunter. The issues now to me, though, is this could be one of the instances where experience does trump youth. And I, like I said, my head is saying Klitschko, but my heart wants to say Joshua, because Klitschko winning means he has he may have a stranglehold on the division again. Joshua winning just opens the avenue for everybody, including, like I said, from Joseph Parker, who's now facing some other guy because Hugo Fury did some fuckery. And we know who's going to be there at Wembley sitting ringside. One Mr. Deontay Wilder, ready to call out whoever wins.
And this is where I come in. I'm glad you set the stage for me, because here's the thing. Live by the sword, die by the sword. All the things you said Klitschko can do to Joshua, Joshua can do back to Klitschko. What's Klitschko going to do at 41 when he feels a strong pop come at him? You're gonna be a little bit different, especially when you haven't seen it in a year. What's Klitschko going to do for being out of the ring in a year in there with someone whose reflexes, iron sharp as iron? Joshua's been fighting, so we've seen it come together. This is the moment where we might see Joshua like we've seen a lot of great fighters. Floyd Mayweather when he fought Genaro Hernandez, Oscar De La Hoya when he went for his first title, Felix Trinidad when he went for his first title. This could be the moment we might see James Tony Michael Nunn, where the young guy comes in there and he dethrones the old lion, where he steps his game up. This could be the moment, because we've been seeing this progression from him. Klitschko, on the other hand, these are the three reasons why I got Joshua. Because, number one, Klitschko lost to Tyson Fury, and Tyson Fury is athletic, and I believe Anthony Joshua is more athletic than Tyson Fury. And if he can use that athleticism, that gives Vladimir Klitschko problems. Go back to the Sam Peters fight. He was using his feet. He was using those movements. Joshua can do that. Another reason is that 1 year being out of the ring and being 40-some years old, it's going to take more time for his reflexes and timing to catch up with him. I don't care how much sparring he's been doing and who he's been sparring with, which I know for a fact he's been sparring with younger guys. But that still, in an actual real fight, it's totally different. Real time is totally different than sparring. And the third reason why is, after the Tyson Fury fight, I don't know where Vladimir Klitschko is mentally. Yeah, he seems to be okay, but when the bell rings and that first punch come at him, how's he going to respond? Okay, so I just think those things are working against him. But I want to say this right here, and I'm glad you said this. This is probably the most relevant fight in heavyweight division in the last 15 years. But the winner of this fight, especially if it's Anthony Joshua, has rendered Deontay Wilder a fucking belt holder in the heavyweight division. That's what it's done, because you're talking about a guy with half as less fights than you, taking the training wheels off and going for it while you're still over there talking Mando. I get this argument everybody all the time. Yes, he was waiting for Povetkin. Yes, he wanted Fury. Yes, he wanted Vladimir Klitschko. But those fights didn't happen. For whatever reason, they didn't happen. This fight is happening. Why? So if Anthony Joshua wins, yeah, Deontay Wilder is going to be heavily criticized. He's going to have a lot to answer for, because it's going to render him a fucking belt holder in the heavyweight division, because you got almost 40 fights, and the best name on your resume is Burmester Burn. And
he's technically there now already.
Well, yeah, well, it's still there. But what I'm saying is, I didn't need to see Duhapis. You could have gave me a Big Baby Miller. I didn't need to see Eric Molina. You could have gave me a Luis Ortiz. If he'd have fought Luis Ortiz, we wouldn't even be talking like this about it right now.
Damn, so, Bo needs a beat, man. I'm loving this.
This is why people shouldn't be boxing. This is why you should never be a fan of a fighter and be a fan of a sport. That way you can call it down the middle. Bullshit is bullshit. Dude, you got almost 40 fights, and you got a guy with 18 fights that's taking his fucking training wheels off, the hat, the knee pads, the elbow pads, and said, fuck it, I'm going for the gusto. While you're still over here telling me how you don't want to fight a guy because he failed a drug test, which I get you coming back from injury, but you shouldn't say that. Then you say the stupidest shit I've ever heard in my life, which is, I don't need skill when I got power. That is the most dumbest goddamn thing I've ever fucking heard.
I heard that. And
you are a professional fighter, and you're sitting here telling me that you basically just told me you are a one-dimensional goddamn fighter, and you just gave credence to everybody that criticized you. So if Anthony Joshua wins, Deontay Wilder's a fucking belt holding heavyweight division, and that's what it is until he beat somebody of relevancy. And that's get mad at me all you want. My name is Bo, Chicago Truth and Facts. Whatever. Fuck it.
Bo. No, Bo, you were – no, it's true.
That comment.
Deontay Wilder – well,
that was
technically,
comment. No, not at all. Oh,
yeah. Deontay Wilder's technically still a belt holder anyway. Like I said, this fight, we mentioned it. This could be the changing of the guard for the heavyweight division. He's pretty much already been relegated to a belt holder anyway. So, but it's not going to change. It's not really going to change anything. But the fact of the matter is, but I get it. Like, Joshua's the one stepping up, which is why we're praising him. He's the one stepping up into it.
But now Deontay Wilder is calling out Joseph Park. You should have been doing that. Why did it take this for you to do that? That should have been when you won that belt, you had your one title defense or your second title defense. That should have been your next agenda.
To his credit, he has called out Parker a few times. Parker just ain't it.
He's called out Parker. He's called out Fury with the first bet coming in. Parker was too green there, and, well, we know Fury's fuckery, so...
I ain't no Deontay Wilder defender. I think Joshua would just run through him just as easily as he's gonna do Klitschko. But let's take the time to realize Klitschko made this fight. Joshua, Klitschko and the UK fan base made this fight. Period. Like, it wasn't Joshua like, I better get this or I'm chasing him. Put me in there right now. Klitschko said, look, get me now or you're never getting me. And I'm going after this bitch.
Tyson Fury's coke dealer made this fight.
Well, ultimately. But Schwarzenegger does have a point, because Klitschko could have went and fought whoever contender for a belt, and they would have just granted for him. The fact that Klitschko said, I want this guy, and the fact that Joshua said, okay, let's do it. I'm going for the gusto here. Because I believe I'm all that. 50-50 here. Both fighters made that, and credit should go to both of them for making this fight, because they both could have went another route, and they would have been.
Criticism
would not have been levied on them.
No, not really. Yeah,
I'm just saying, as far as Wilder, I don't think he would have turned it down. I don't think nobody in their right mind would have turned down the last what they saw at Klitschko. So that's why I'm looking at it, really saying it's all Vladimir to me.
And you're saying if Vlad would have went to Wilder and said, let's do it.
Yeah, Wilder it would have happened.
Yeah, okay.
It would have happened, no doubt about it.
It's got to that point where it could have happened already. We would have had the same bullshit with the networks, but it probably would have happened to me because Wilder, what I said, a lot of what Wilder has went through is not his own fault. I do understand that. But at the same time, yeah, you're now seeing Anthony Joshua, who doesn't have 20 fights to his resume yet, about to leapfrog you. And granted, yes, like you could have made a fight, Joseph Parker. You could have made a fight. Big Baby Miller, I wouldn't put him there yet. Give me a couple other fights and not have him have that jiggly shit.
Well, first off, let Big Baby Miller actually live up to what he says.
Yeah, there's that.
Back down to in the 260s and early, low 270s and say he's going to be 270 his fight and then show up his next fight weighing more. Can we please get his weight back down, please? So yeah, he can be at his best.
Yeah, like I said, and Tyson Fury, all Tyson Fury has to do is just lay off the cocoa for probably a good 3 years.
All this that we're saying about the heavyweight division, I think Joshua's going to be the king of it. But I just think his credit for being the king of it is going to be in question when we got to say all this about if Tyson Fury stops doing coke. If Wilder ever gets better, ever steps up, if Baby Miller ever does anything, I just don't see the division where we always, if, you know, like the his best opponent is about to be a guy that's, it's not his fault. I think Klitschko's 41 years old, coming off a year and a half layoff, and looked like total fool in his last fight. But so the question is, how much credit is a heavyweight, any heavyweight that just goes in there and they look dominant? They might end up getting less credit than Klitschko actually got for being dominant for years if they can do it.
But here's the thing, Scorsese. You're technically correct. The thing is, though, given the cachet that Klitschko has built up, and we will all see because we don't know, we will all see what goes down next week. But if Joshua wins and if he dominates, he may not be technically considered the guy, but in turn, he cannot be considered the best heavyweight out there, but he can be considered the guy because of who he beats, especially if he beats him in impressive fashion. In a strange way, if you understand what I mean, you can be not necessarily prove yourself to be the man, in terms of the best, but you can be that guy with the it factor, the money maker, the cash cow. And if Joshua does it, and for the record, let me say, I think that Joshua is going to win. I think at some point he's going to catch Klitschko with shots. I think the age and the inactivity will catch up. I just don't trust. We may not trust Joshua's chin, but I just don't necessarily trust Klitschko's chin against a guy with this kind of power, especially if he's not allowed to hold. Because you notice when he's not allowed to hold, you can hit him with shots. And Joshua is precise enough, he's accurate enough, and he has the subtle quickness and skill to, I think, get through to shots on Klitschko. So I just think he's going to catch him and eventually stop him. But if Joshua beats him and beats him in impressive fashion, you couldn't consider him the best, but you can consider him that guy, that central figure, because he's going to be the cash cow. No doubt about it.
There's massive concerns regarding Joshua's chin, though, Mike, and that's one of the
It things. Is. That's true.
16-ounce gloves. He's been knocked spark out, and Matchroom have done everything in their capacity to try and to prevent those rumors, so to speak, for being exposed, but to the extent where they're actually signing the fighters who actually knocked him out as well. It's crazy, isn't it? There's just so many questions with this fight.
There's the thing, when it comes with Joshua, though, like I said, those have been relegated to rumors. We've seen Klitschko's chin fall apart before our eyes.
But they're not. He's admitted the David Price knockout. He came out himself and told him about that. But he hasn't spoke about the Lawrence Okolie knockout.
When he's been asked about him being put down and out in the past, he's basically held up the old code in boxing, is that in that you don't really talk about sparring sessions. That's a private thing. I mean, look, let's do some history here, historical context. 83, either around the time, shortly before, shortly after Camacho won his first world title, there was a sparring session with Whitaker. Whitaker wiped the floor with him, boxed his shoes off. When Whitaker was asked about that sparring session years later, he didn't talk about it. Mayweather and Spence, help put it this way. The reason Mayweather has had those rib injuries in the past was because of what Lamont Peterson did to him in sparring. They don't talk about it. You notice that nobody really says anything about Spence and
Adrian Broner,
but we know what's happened.
Yeah. We know that story, yeah.
Person I've really given real admission to what happens was Leonard, when him and Aaron Pryor had a run in after the the second Duran fight, where Leonard was talking about, and Aaron Pryor basically challenged him. He was like, yeah, the story's about me knocking you down and you knocking me down and blah, blah, blah. So he, when it comes to Joshua, he basically has held the old line, the old code, that when it comes to sparring, you don't talk about it.
Yeah, let's not forget, like, if you're going to talk sparring tales, like the legendary tale with Sweet Pea and Floyd, where a drunk Sweet Pea made Floyd look like a fool in sparring.
Well, better yet, the Spadafora one.
I was just going to say, Paul Spadafora.
Spadafora was getting ready for his first title defense December 99. Floyd had a fight that previous September, hadn't been back in the gym. Floyd decides to jump back in there because he was young and arrogant and full of himself. And after a couple rounds, it was like Spadafora was like, take my shirt off. He took the shirt off, and then the last three, four rounds of that sparring session, Spadafora had his way with him to the point that Floyd was exhausted crawling out the ring afterwards.
Yeah, and even Harold Bummer Graham and Chris Eubank Sr., after their session, Chris Eubank was like, there's no way on earth I want to fight you.
And hit him with one shot. He hit him with one shot. The entire sparring session would put Bummer Graham down. So, I mean, the stories abound. I mean, Tyson and Lewis. How many folks knew that they sparred before their fight in 2002? How many folks knew that they sparred
the amateurs
20 years prior?
Amateurs, yeah. They were amateur sparring partners.
Right.
Tyson and Carl the Truth Williams.
Right. So, yeah, the fact that Leonard, preparing for Hackler, got knocked down by Quincy Taylor here in my home state in sparring.
There's a lot of those. Yeah, like you mentioned, Mike, there's a lot of those stories. And this year, Joshua, for the most part, doesn't talk about it, but they do get out. And unfortunately, that does fall into the line. But like I said, the best evidence is the Dillian White fight. Is showing if you can hit him to the body. And it goes to the adage of what Bo mentioned a lot of times, when the guys that are built a lot of muscle. He said it takes a lot of oxygen to keep those muscles moving. And if you hit a guy to a body, that's less oxygen he's going to take it to the body. That's more energy he has to expend moving around those muscles. Yeah, it's one of the reasons why. Yeah, I'm sorry, guys, but it's one of the reasons that Klitschko amazingly has looked leaner in the lead up to this fight. He hasn't looked as bold as he has been recently.
I would like to see what he does when he thinks he's going to be able to drape on Joshua. I think if he tries the whole, he's going to set himself up to be too close to a monster. I just think that ends, but I think you get, it's like you try to hold Porter. I see you getting out muscled, getting thrown out the way. He just get physical, and then he's going to set up shots after that. That might be the thing that gets him knocked out. And then, as you mentioned, the body shots, he's not going to the body. It's not happening.
Yeah, my only pushback, Scorsese, is Porter, both physically and mentally, he's built for that. That's what he does. Joshua, while he has the physique, the mentality there, as well as the style, is not the same
as
Porter. So it will be interesting to see if Klitschko starts using those tactics. How he
reacts. I want to say that. If he does, if he doesn't do it, if he does not, if he's going to look like Adonis, not Stevenson, but just look like Adonis, just the bodybuilder Adonis, if you're going to look this way and you're not physical, and I think he is a physical fighter. I haven't had to see him do it, but I've seen him just killer instinct, do what he got to do to hurt people. I think he's going to see him do that. He's going to push him off, and that's how he's going to get him knocked out. And then he's going to stand up there, and he's going to act like, hey, this guy gave me a shot. I'm so grateful. I'm ever grateful. All this grateful stuff he's doing now, I think it's about to turn into monster mode. You've got to be ready for the Clinton. How can his cornermen call themselves cornermen if you're saying, hey, this guy clinches? He fought a bigger guy his last fight, and he tried to drape him. We're going to have you ready for that. If they don't do that, how do they even call themselves cornermen?
Fair point. But again, we just have to see it. We have to see it. Preparation is one thing. You have to see it once it happens to you.
But see, that's the intriguing thing about this fight. We can talk about what can go wrong and what can go right, but it's one of those fights where we really don't know what's going to work until we see it.
Mm. Yep. And guess what? We forced to watch Sky Sports.
I didn't get your prediction, Daniel.
Like I said, I'm 50-50 on it. My heart wants to say Joshua. My heart really wants to say Joshua and says that he has all the technical skills necessary to wipe out Klitschko. But I've seen enough in the sport where age does trump youth. Experience does trump youth at times. And for some reason, I have a feeling this could be one of those fights.
Because hey Gus and Daniel, I got y'all favorite food over here in my microwave, chicken. Y'all killing me with these predictions, man.
Hey, if it's arroz con pollo con gallo pinto, dámelo.
Dámelo de esto inmediatamente.
Bo, you know, I mean, I'm the smartest motherfucker on the planet when it comes to betting, man. So you can keep your salmonella chicken, man.
Hey, like this, though. I think it's experience and youth, and I eventually have to look and say, but what's in his favor with that experience? Like, he ain't never had no experience with nobody like Josh. He never had no experience with nobody like this guy. Same size, just crazy punching, crazy speed, putting punches together. Come on, man. At some point, you got to say, okay, you do have a boxing mind.
Excuse me.
But the last I saw of you, then speak highly of your experience. And we had, and last time we also said he's never fought nobody like this, but he has the experience. This is the second time in a row we're doing this. I guess I'm pre-closing the curtain on Klitschko, and I'm calling it like, yo, I'm not about to sit up and play. I don't know no more. It's done. It's it. The new guard is in. The punch is going to come from everywhere. His eyes are going to be closed when he's getting knocked out. It's going to be – he shouldn't be in the ring. I just – the money made him do it. The money made him do it.
Yeah, and history has showed us that a long layoff, especially for older fighters, is not good at all.
And he probably also did it to piss off Tyson Fury. Like, with all the bullshit that Tyson Fury put him through, and then the bullshit in the rematch – he said, okay, I'll fight the guy that you want to fight.
Yeah, man, these guys are making, what, $15 million each? So why not?
I thought they would be making – well, that sounds about right. That sounds about right. So, fascinating matchup. You really can't call it. But for the record, Bo, you have Joshua winning. Scorsese, you have him wiping the floor with Klitschko up.
Come on, Bo, give a round, then.
He should have won for Wilder. You said give a round?
Yeah.
Oh, I think you're making money between one's round one and four.
I've got one and four.
It's early. I think it's going to be pretty convenient to us boxing fans just watching.
Daniel's kind of hedging. His head says one thing. His heart says the other thing.
He's a smart man.
I think Gus is like Joshua, I believe, and he's siding with Joshua, and I'm siding with Joshua. So,
but Mike, when the fight got announced, I took Klitschko straight away because they were given 15-2.
They knew.
Yeah, like
Gus, I was like straight away.
Gus is speaking with his pounds in his wallet. That's what he's speaking with.
All right. Indeed. So yeah, this is going to be interesting. And let me say for the record, there will be a live show, live episode, Pound for Pound Boxing Report post fight immediately following Joshua Klitschko. So as soon as the fight is over, you can check us out here. Any and all is welcome. I need to talk to you, Bo, about some folks after this episode is over with. Can't wait for it. Really looking forward to it. I'm pumped up about it. And I think we're going to start to shut the show down, go around to hang out here. Starting with you, Bo, from Truth and Facts About Boxing. Shout out to Isha, the casual boxing fan listening to us live. She said, you're speaking the truth, Bo. So for folks who want to talk to Sweet Science, or for folks who want to follow the trails and the hilarity that is the stories with you and your daughter, let the folks know where they can find you.
Hopefully they can find me not in the closet. She's upset that I took her phone and put her on punishment right now.
Yeah.
A 16-year-old girl without phone or internet is dangerous. But you can find me on Truth and Facts About Boxing at YouTube. Also, you can follow me and my partner in crime, Bernard, on Twitter at capital T for truth, _ capital F for fact, box one. Also, Instagram, Truth and Facts About Boxing. And you can also catch me on right here on Pound for Pound. You can catch me collaborating also with Daniel and the Movement Podcast with my man Twan the Divine Liberty, 2K the God from the Gods of Boxing, and Big Cool from Colossal Boxing Talk. And shout out to Gail who wasn't here, and Jacobs who left. Big shout out and props to them. And pay attention to this podcast, because I got a feeling after the Joshua Klitschko fight, it's going to get real hot up in here.
Yeah, indeed. Again, like you said, shout out to Gail. She couldn't make it tonight. She had a prior engagement. I believe she's going to try to be part of the live show. She's not going to miss next week. So she's not a fan of Chavez Jr. So I'm going to just give her the floor to rail on that. Supposed to attend, I think, like a presser with Chavez Jr. and his crew Monday. Out in California, or in Vegas, I should say. So we'll be on the lookout for that. Also, shout out to Jacob from Jab Hook Boxing, who joined us early on the show. Go to you, Scorsese, for folks who want to talk to Sweet Science or anything else. Let the folks know where they can hit you up.
If anybody want to talk any boxing, talk just about anybody want to talk it. My Twitter is at @MyLowPlace. One word, and my YouTube is what, Low Place, hashtag MLPF. And I need to get back active on that. It's fun doing YouTube videos. So, yeah, need to get back active.
Daniel from the Inscriber, for folks who want to talk, the Sweet Science, who want to talk politics, or who want to talk the NBA, specifically the Miami Heat, let the folks know where they can hit you up.
Folks, yeah, you can definitely find me on Twitter at Ruckus99. You can find my work at the Inscriber Digital Magazine. Find all the work of the good boxing writer, Peter Clark. And also, they said, do my own podcast. Depends on the date. But we do it with Joe Francis for Four Boxing News. They occasionally join us here. And you better catch in that live show now. Depends. Are we doing it after the live or after the tape delay?
I'm going to try to do it after the live. If HBO don't catch me.
he coming.
If HBO don't catch me, I'm gonna try and do it right after the live.
All right, so I have to split time between EJ and you guys, but I think EJ understand.
Yeah, it's gonna be popping off. Everybody's gonna probably do some kind of live show, so I said, I don't do it often, fuck it, might as well do something myself. So there you go. Gus from Corruption and Boxing, for folks who want to talk to Sweet Science or talk music. Let the folks know where they can hit you up.
Yeah, if I'm still alive, not sort of dying, chewing on chicken bones, you can catch me on...
Or checking your first person who delivers, or you check out for that greenery.
I thought he was a vegetarian for a minute. I just passed me over, man. Shit was funny, man.
Man, you guys need to look up what a green grocer is in the U.S. Yeah. It's too much misconception, man.
Yes, Gus. Yes.
I used to be a greengrocer, but I never heard that. And I was just like, oh shit, he hit me with one right there.
Yeah, like you've been dropping from Master Flex bombs lately. This year in this podcast.
You're gonna help me get in my contract with Ring Magazine if they're listening to this, man.
Like, damn, when did Gus switch over to, you know, his vegetarian lifestyle? What's going on?
Well, if they haven't gotten mad at us when after you, me, and Charlie Brown went through their top 10 lists, I think we're safe.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah. For folks who want to talk to Swing Side,
you know what, Mike. After what has transpired today, folks can't catch me anywhere because I'm disconnecting all of my channels, man. No corruption in boxing. Music-wise, I've got a lot on at the moment. Doing a lot of stuff on Juno Beatport. Catch me a covert operative as well.
Indeed. And for folks who want to talk to Sweet Science or music or anything else with me, Brother JR on Twitter at Brother JR76. Again, as I said to begin the show, if you want to check out all things regarding Pound for Pound Box Report, check out the blog page. Check out the blog, please. P4PBoxReport.wordpress.com. That's the link. Check the right of the page. You'll find links to the pages on G+, YouTube, Tumblr, as well as Twitter, as well as links to where to listen to us on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher Radio, Google Play, and Player FM. Next episode, we will do a full recap of Joshua and Klitschko. There are some folk fights that's going to be happening in an interim. Donnie Nietzsche, I know he's going to be fighting for the vacant flyweight belt. Didn't have time to talk about it here because I wanted to full focus on Joshua and Klitschko, but I promise we will do a recap of that Nietzsche's fight, who's fighting in his home country, the Philippines, also on the same day. We will also do a preview of Scorsese's, one of Scorsese's favorite fighters, Mr. Redbeard, Canelo Alvarez, who will be fighting Julio Cesar Chavez Jr. In Vegas. David Lemieux is fighting on the undercard. I believe Lucas Matisse is making his comeback as well. And Joseph Parker is going to be, he will make first defense of his WBO title. So we're going to talk about all those bouts plus any other news in the interim. So, yeah, for both from Truth and
Facts. Quick question. If Chavez Jr. pull off the upset, is he in anybody's early running for fight of the year?
Nope. And just move on. Just nope.
Gus?
Not one Gus? Win. Not off nope. of one win. Nope.
Gus?
Yeah, he'll make my pound for pound list, yeah.
Bo, what you did?
I'm going to save my comment for when Gail is on the show.
Yeah, Gail might excommunicate you for that one.
I'm going to say it. And
if he wins. I just
said Mike and Daniel know exactly what I'm going to say. But I'm gonna
yes.
Say
if he wins.
Nope. He knocks Keith Thurman off number 10 on my pound for pound list. Yeah.
Nope.
Okay.
If he wins, he becomes the greatest Mexican fighter that ever lived. Gail, if you're listening, Chavez is going to be the greatest Mexican fighter that ever lived.
Oh, God.
Taking out a hitman to the hood, man.
Nope.
Okay. Damn. No love for Chavez Jr.
Hell no. If he's good enough to beat Canelo, the question will be, how come he didn't show up like that in all his other fights? So no, I ain't giving him no credit for that. Back to the thing. Follow me on Twitter, Brother JR at Brother JR76. Check out all things regarding the Pound for Pound Box Report. Check out the blog page, please. P4PBoxReport.wordpress.com. Right of the page, links to the pages, Facebook, G+, Tumblr, Twitter, also where to listen to us on iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, Radio, Player FM, Google Play Music. We will talk about that Chavez bout. Lucas Matisse is fighting also on that weekend. on that same card. David Lemieux, I mentioned Joseph Parker. Any other bouts in that interim? So yeah, for Bowen from Truth and Facts About Boxing, for Scorsese of the Lion's Den of Fame, for Daniel the Inscriber, for Jacob who joined us earlier on the show. Yeah, episode 167, Pound for Pound Box Report. Joshua Klitschko preview. Live show next week immediately following the fight. But until then, we will see y'all next time. Everybody have a good evening.
Sayonara.
Good night. And shout out to Isha for listening to us live in the comments.
Yes.